Japan. How have you been, Ben? Looks like you're busy with your cartoons and stuff.
I'm doing lots of cartooning. I have I spent the day doing some inking on one assignment and laying out another one. I was laying that our friend Adam Garcia wrote this Spider-Man story like 10 years ago for me, and I decided to play with it a little bit.
Nice. So you have like a Comic-Con coming up or something you're doing?
I have a small convention. I work with adults with disabilities, and I help them make comics, and I take them to conventions.
Oh, wow.
That's my job. Yeah, it's a great gig. It's my favorite.
Yeah,
it's
a better person than I am.
Well, it's what I do. It lets me, it's flexible. I get to freelance and do whatever I need to do around that. So it's a pretty good deal for me.
Nice.
Yeah.
When is that? When is your next one?
That one's in 2 weeks, and then we're trying to do the big alternative press one here in New York, and that's in April.
Oh, nice.
But that one's curated, so we'll see if we get into it. I work with some really, really talented people.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So we're doing that. And then I have a book that I'm the pitch is just wrapping up, so that's good.
Nice.
So we should move on to the next.
Who's in my lap?
Jesus Christ.
But I did ironically find a real pen that I didn't know was in my couch. I also found my 64 gig flash drive that I hadn't lost for a year. And I found a 3.5 to, looks like another 3.5 millimeter adapter.
There's treasure everywhere.
Yeah. I did cut myself on some rusty nails, so
all the treasure.
This will be my final show. Hey, Corey.
Hey, Jack.
Cheers, fellas.
Hey, Corey.
Yeah. Hey, how's it going, Ben?
I'm good, man. How are you? Are you guys both in Wisconsin now? Is that the living arrangements?
Practically.
Corey, where do you live?
I just moved from Northern California to Michigan.
To Michigan. Okay, so you're close back.
Hell of a change, though.
Yeah. Yeah, it's been an interesting adjustment.
All
right. Did it snow by you last night?
Oh shit, yes. Oh, it's been snowing for the last, it stopped at some point in the middle of the night. But last night and a little bit of the night before, it was just coming down completely yesterday. It was beautiful.
Somebody got a haircut.
Hey, it looks awesome.
I know, when he turned his hat, I couldn't tell if it was pulled back or if it's gone.
Mine's gone.
It looks good.
Thank you. I still got to figure out what to do with the beard.
Well, that's... Yeah, I don't know. Don't ask me. I look homeless.
Well, I figure once I'm employed, I can start to look homeless again. But for right now, I have that's to fucking make an effort.
You grow facial hair pretty quick, though. So I guess if you had to shave it or trim it pretty tight, it wouldn't be a big deal.
I had gotten my first professional shave just before I left California, and it was real embarrassing. My wife has only seen my upper lip twice in our relationship of 20 years, and neither one has been very pleasing for her. So it was kind of upsetting, and I had to grow that back real, real fast. I was like plugging my nose and ears and blowing, just hoping. Grew a second penis. It's as unimpressive as the first one is, though, so it doesn't matter.
How was the shave? I only did it once, and when I lived in the city, I always went to a barber college where I'd get $4 haircuts. And, they would usually do a pretty bad job. There were students that were learning, but it was $4, and it was nearby. And usually the teacher would come by and kind of, fix it and, give them pointers. I don't know why, but at one point I always saw it on the menu, and I was like, I want to shave. And the kid... He was just like, really? And I was like, yeah. And then he's basically takes out the blade. He's holding it as if it's a lightsaber, and he doesn't know what he's doing. And he puts it to my neck, and he's nervous. And now I'm nervous.
You've just given him a license to murder.
Yeah. And the reason I wanted it is because I just to this day, after nearly 20 years of shaving, I still do a terrible job, and I get razor burn really bad on my neck. And yeah, and I thought it would be better, and it wasn't. He butchered me.
The lady was skilled, so there wasn't any kind of irritation or anything. She knew when to go with the grain or whatever. She just, like a lot of haircuts I get, she went too short. I'm not very good at describing what I want. I put myself in the trust of the people that I'm with, and it just turned out to be not what I had intended when I went in there. But the experience was great, and she was very nice and very attentive, and the whole thing was fun. I would do it again, but the place that I went to out here, my mom took me to where she gets her haircut, and it's a bunch of ladies with Midwest hair. I was just like, let's just go with what you think is fashionable for a dude around here, and I'll shave when I get home.
I'm curious what you consider Midwest hair.
That short in the back, long bangs, looks like they got a bump it right on the crown. That is, there were two women of probably at least a 15-year age difference in that place that were both cutting hair that both had that hairstyle. Sounds and there were, I think, five women working, so it wasn't like it was the greater portion of the women had it, but it was very noticeable.
Women working.
Yeah.
I lost my train of thought. I'm getting so distracted. Can you guys hear the audio pops that I'm having?
No.
All right, good. They're driving me nuts. I literally turned off the power to my sound system, and I'm still getting them.
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask how that was going.
Driving me nuts. I had to watch both movies with them, and after trying unsuccessfully to stream them on my iPad and my MacBook Air, life is just terrible. But I just want to say something about the hair, the shave, and I lost it. Fuck, shit. No, I'm my brain's got my brain is just.
This is awesome.
It's just like meat and fat. Now there's nothing else there. There's no left. Just
meat
left.
And fat.
There's no light. I totally forgot what I wanted to say about
Christmas. By the way, meat and fat is two of my favorite things in the world. So just like,
how's my levels?
I can't feel bad for you with that.
You're fine.
I'm trying to open up your YouTube page because I feel bad. I always ignore your chat.
Oh, don't worry. So do I.
Is it chat at the same time?
Yeah, they're fans.
Can you super chats?
Participate.
Jack, can you turn yourself up a little?
That's why I was asking how my levels are.
No, yeah, Beatmaster said it. You needed to be better.
You always trust in Beatmaster.
And I just don't give a shit about anything anymore.
By the way, hi Brandon.
Where do I go?
To go to YouTube.
Are we live right now?
Yeah. So,
oh boy,
just keep your clothes on.
Or don't.
Get or don't. Yeah, I don't care anymore.
What do we care if we get banned?
Wait.
Take this motherfucker to Twitch.
What? What, are they the terrorists? The people in the chat? What's it called?
One of them is from a foreign country, so make of that what you will.
Oh, Jesus.
Put that on your wall building agenda. That's nice to have an international. Wow, okay.
Yeah, but he's from Switzerland, so he's pretty much neutral.
You never say correctly where he's from.
Nope. But I think he's actually from Switzerland, so I think I got it this time.
Yeah, no, he's from Switzerland, so he's pretty much neutral.
Say correctly where he's from.
Jack, is that you?
But I think he's actually from Switzerland.
I'm on mute.
He's from Switzerland.
Ben, are you playing the video?
Someone's playing the video back.
Yeah, Ben's playing the video back. Ben, you cannot be unmuted until you mute that fucking video.
Or just pause the video and you can watch the chat. Or you can
Can
chat.
You do that? Can you, if I pause it, the chat will keep going?
Yeah, you can. I pop the chat out. Ah, fuck yeah, I was right. I told you guys, Beatmaster is from Switzerland.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Don't say that, though. Don't give into it.
Don't be right.
Don't give him the satisfaction of you knowing where he is. That would be like telling Rally Bear you actually know what time zone he's in.
He's from Singapore.
Can you unmute our guest?
Oh, shit, sorry. I'm trying to...
I've remembered what I wanted
to say. No, I can't unmute him.
Ben, we can't hear you at the moment. Matt's an idiot.
Yeah, Ben, I muted you, and now won't let me unmute you.
I understand.
Yeah, I was just fucking... He's a mom.
How does that happen? There's no way. Like, you can't
there
just
be...
unmute. I remembered what I wanted to say.
Yeah, he just did it himself.
There he is. I remember what I wanted to say. I agree with Corey about not knowing like how to tell them what kind of haircut. I've never successfully communicated the kind of haircut I get. I just, one out of every three or four is the one I wanted, and I just go with those odds. Somebody did a great tweet where it's just they butch, like barber butches your hair, does awful job, makes you want to kill yourself. Holds up mirror, looks great, thanks.
Yes, that's exactly right.
Take a photo of yourself when you have a good haircut and say,
"I know, but it's so
like the guy in the photo."
I can't do that. It's so awkward and weird.
I've gone in with photos of celebrities and stuff when I've had like a specific hairstyle, but I found it a lot easier when my wife worked for Ulta to just go in when she was working, and then she would tell the person how to cut my hair, because it doesn't matter what I do, it's never going to be her happy when I get home. So if she's at least there for what happens, the blame lands on her, and she won't tell me that she doesn't like it.
I just found out from somebody on Twitter, somebody posted something like, "What is 2019 the year men stop getting this haircut? Do they know they look like neo-Nazis?" And I was offended because that's the haircut I always want that I can never get. It's the basically like the shaved on the sides, the kind of like not a full Guido fade up, but I like to be very short on the sides because I have very curly hair and it grows quicker on the sides because I'm going bald. So I look like Krusty the Clown after 6 weeks. So I wanted as short as possible to let the top keep up. But apparently that's a neo-Nazi haircut. Actually, you know, Ben was, I was maybe the first person Ben met when he moved to New York City.
When he showed up in his neo-Nazi movement.
Do you remember what I looked like? Staten Island as I was going to get, because that was, from that day forward, I slowly became more gentrified into the rest of the city culture. But that was my accent was probably at its thickest. My haircut was definitely at its most Guido. I had my silver chain still. I had a little mustache.
Okay, right.
I want to see that. Do you have pictures?
Yeah, I have my NYU ID somewhere probably. Yeah, and then me and Ben went out for lunch or dinner within 15, 20 minutes of meeting each other. And
I assume you just went and ate Italian food.
He spilled soda all over my food.
And then you just was beepity bobbity boopity.
No, I was fine. I was like, all right, whatever. He's freaking out. He thought he just made an enemy for life.
I made an enemy for life. Welcome to New York. You're going to die here.
You spilling Diet Coke on my burger over here. But yeah, me and Ben lived together our first year, freshman year, and I love him like a brother. He's amazing.
Oh, so
you guys gonna kiss real quick, or
it wouldn't be quick.
I mean, well, I got time.
Trying to dig up a fight. I don't know if
I'm waiting.
You've seen photos of me in high school. I don't need to dig these up.
But I want to see full Guido Jack.
Like, did you see my prom?
Probably. I also saw a weird picture of you dressed up like Robin. I can't unforget that. I can't unsee that one.
A couple years ago.
Doesn't make it any better.
I'll send you pictures of me as Robin then.
Oh, God. I imagine you're just naked with a mask on.
Wait till you see my red hood. I'm kidding. I'm sorry.
No, you're not.
That's going to show us his Nightwing. Did you know that they're changing Dick Grayson's name in the comics now? They finally determined like we can't call him Dick anymore and get away with it. So they wiped his memory and have him redoing his whole life from scratch. And they want him to be called Rick Grayson instead.
What? This can't be real.
So well, no. I'm pushing for Rick to be the new slang for Wang.
What's right? Come on. There's nothing wrong with Dick.
Yeah, it's not like it's Keith.
You're gonna offend all the Keiths in the audience. That's crazy. I don't know.
Offend the Keiths. Keith has had it too good for too long.
Okay, so before we lose our entire listener bases of Keiths, I do want to point out, Jack. I know Ben. Do you like football at all?
I watched 15 minutes of football today.
Okay, so. Yeah, it's pretty on par. I know it's Corey's Keith. Favorite sport. Yeah, it's very Keith of you. So the Bears lost last week by 1 point because their kicker missed the 43-yard field goal.
Yeah, so that was terrible.
Yes. So a brewery in Chicago basically said, come down here Saturday, kick a 43-yard field goal, get free beer for a year.
What?
People fucking lined up for five hours.
How big of a field goal?
43 yards.
Oh, Jeff could do that with his eyes closed. We got to get Jeff out there.
Well, it was, he already missed it, but everyone missed. It was also snowing, and most people like ate shit when they kicked. But yeah, I'm sure Jeff could have done it.
Can you only get one kick, or can you just like keep going?
Nope, one kick.
That's it.
Yeah, you don't even get to warm up. Like, I've never kicked one a field goal.
But you also don't have the other team trying to tag you out.
No.
That's true. You have all the time in the world. You're not against an offensive line that is trying to collectively butt rape you.
Move your colon to another portion of your anatomy. Yeah, that
with their penis.
I appreciate this fucking thing for what it is, which is, you come down here and show me how you can do it, bitch.
There was another video I found, and it was like people who were watching college football, and it's like, I can make that field goal. So I think it was ESPN. But they flew the people in, and they were like, hey, do you know why you're here? And they're like, no, I have no clue. And then they handed them the tweet, and then they figured out that they were going to have to take the kick. And everyone fucking missed that thing, too.
Also, imagine the physicality of a person who's trying to win free beer for a year has got to be like Captain America levels of masculinism.
Yeah. There's some peak athletes at this event.
And you know it's not a real year. I remember when I got a year of internet when I first got 56K. And I blew through that shit on South Park chat rooms 6 months.
Well, you know, they say if you get like a year of something, it's usually, you know, like what, a six pack a week. But I think it's from the brewery itself. So it might be like two or three pours a week.
Oh, God. Jack Salty Balls say, this internet is bullshit. I can't believe I'm not paying for this.
Your previous guest, Jeff Walenek, he's the kicker for the Predators. He can kick. He can do 40, 50-yard field goals. He's really talented.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he has that soccer background, which I believe helps.
Yeah.
And the fact that he actually, like, kicks field goals.
But does he want the free beer for a year, or will he donate it to charity? Like, here's my free year of beer to local AA or something.
I could see a year's worth of beer for Jeff being an actual year's worth of beer.
Jeff doesn't drink that much?
He can live in moderation.
Must be nice.
Yeah, well, we make him drive everywhere. He's the only one still left to drive, so he can't take that much.
Why don't you just take an Uber? You have those, don't you?
I'd take him. Jeff would never take an Uber.
Why not? Why is Jeff weird?
First of all, to Staten Island, it would be like a $150 cab ride.
I don't know.
Believe me, I've tried. He lives by my father, and it takes me 2.5 hours to get there on the holidays. Because I want Uber. Yeah, I got to take a train to a bus to a train.
Oh, so if you were to drive, how long would that take?
From where I am, I live off the BQE, which is the most congested highway in the world. If there's no traffic, half hour, 25 minutes. But normally it's more like 50 minutes, hour.
Oh, that's not terrible. Sometimes, I mean, yeah, it's not bad, good, but...
Yeah, it ranges.
Huh. Wow.
I got a digital camera in college, so I don't really have any photos from high school. Oh, you know where I could show you photos from high school?
Oh,
I don't think they exist anymore.
Your Tumblr?
No, yeah, me and Dan had a website for our high school sketch group, but I think after like 15 years, I think last year.
What was it called?
Let me see if I can find it.
You'll never tell me what it is?
No, we've been very careful about that.
Oh, fuck. I think I spent some time trying to find it. Or is it a Geocities website?
No, it was not.
Geocities?
Yeah, no, it's gone.
Say Geocities. Yeah, exactly.
Is it Geocities or Geocities?
I was being serious.
Geocities sounds like a
said that.
Sorry, man.
Geocity sounds like an atrocity and a genocide.
Exactly.
I like it. I was like, wow, there's an even better way to say this.
Saying GIF. Oh, fuck.
So with a movie like Bohemian Rhapsody or Walk the Line, I like to call them biopics as opposed to biopics.
See?
Because it's a biography. It's not a biography. So I
call them biopics.
It sounds, you know, more professional than like biopic.
Yeah. I'm with you.
Yeah.
So, you know, myopic about how I say Geocities?
Yeah.
No, but the way you said it was really
cool. I really enjoy Geocities. I think that sounds great.
See, I think it's the way to class it up. It's like putting lemon in your water.
I'm trying to come up with like a WordPress pun. I got nothing. Never mind.
Oh, I hate WordPress. I have to use it all the time too.
Yeah, I got this updated version at work that's been driving me nuts.
Mm-hmm.
So I think now you're supposed to web design for mobile, which. I just tried to, I get this iPad. I spent a goddamn paycheck on half a paycheck. And I haven't used it once, and I'm trying to use it. And it really, my gut was telling me for years I wasn't going to like it. And everybody's like, no, it's great. It's great. It can mostly replace your computer.
Did you get the Pro?
I got the 6, okay. Though, which uses the pencil. Because that's what I wanted. I want to be able to mark on screenplays.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I just trying to make a copy of the PDF and rename it, rename the file because I, so I don't fuck up the original while I make my notes. Just that took me like 5 minutes on the iPad.
No, don't go off script, Jack. Don't take the iPad and expect it to do things that you wanted to do. It's you adjusting to how it wants you to do things. That's all it is.
It's like being married.
It's so intuitive. Hold on. Yeah. I can't find a picture of me, but can I send pictures in this chat now, right?
You can share your screen.
I'm not going to do that.
Oh, you don't want it to be on YouTube?
Yeah, that's why. Anyway, I'm going to send you a screenshot of our door or part of our door. Me and Ben were always very insistent on decorating our dorm door with art. I mean, everybody was in college in the dorms. Yeah. But we had a very specific sense of humor that I don't think anybody else appreciated, at least not on our floor. Let me see if it's...
I cannot wait.
I don't know what it is.
I mean, you guys feel for this is going to take me a couple minutes, so please don't stop the show.
So, okay, good. Great.
Better off telling us not to start the show.
Have you guys seen Glass?
Have we started the show?
Technically, yeah.
That's right. You pre introduce us, right?
Yeah, I do as little work as possible. Glass comes out on Friday, Ben.
On Friday?
Yeah.
Is it going to be good?
I hope so.
So I saw a story earlier today that says that the critics are not liking Glass, but a bunch of people who got to go see it in a triple feature, M. Night
Shyamalan Ding Dong.
Yes, he was there. Oh, he talked the whole thing up, and then they watched sort of what we're doing, except they got to see the third. They watched Unbreakable, Split, and Glass, and most of the audience reaction has been fairly positive.
Oh, good.
But the expectation is that audiences are usually more positive in that sort of situation when they get to see the preview, especially with the director or writer of the film or whatever.
And
so it's
seeking
still kind
it
of
out,
up in
I
here.
Imagine, right?
Right.
It's probably fans of Unbreakable and or Split.
And they're all tagging him in their tweets saying how great it was and stuff. And even then, there's still a little bit of like, eh, it's all right. But yeah, overall, it's probably going to be ostracized by critics and fan wank will enjoy it a lot more.
Is he still on the rise, plateaued, on the way back down?
I think he's on the rise so far. I think this will be the make or break.
Okay.
Oh, that's big. I feel like he should get a pass on this because this is obviously more of a passion project, personal project. I feel like no matter how this one goes, you should get a pass, and then his next one can be, all right, is he back or not? Or maybe he just earns a reputation as an inconsistent filmmaker. I mean, certainly Scorsese and even Spielberg, every once in a while, they have really good ones again, right? Everybody loved Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah.
Do you guys like Shyamalan? Do you like these movies or not like these, or are you neutral about them?
So are we talking Split and Unbreakable or all of Shyamalan's
films? I don't want to jump like, yeah, whatever.
You act like we have rules here.
Yeah.
I don't want to break a format. I don't know if this
there is no format.
Oh, good.
Yeah, we can do whatever you want.
So do you guys like him, not like him, bias, neutral?
I like some of it. Like, yeah. I didn't like watching Unbreakable again. I didn't really think it was that good of a movie. And I know you said you hated it, so. But then I watched Split, and I remembered how fucking good of a movie Split is.
Yeah.
Like, whoever the dude is that played everyone.
McAvoy.
He was amazing.
He's amazing. Yeah.
So good.
But that's the thing is, I think, and I'm going to admit right off the bat, I'm the opposite. I really loved Unbreakable, but I had seen it in the theater and have a love for it because this is before superhero movies were getting popular, and it was kind of a trick on you. You didn't know that it was a superhero movie until actually you saw it. I can definitely look at it now and say, okay, a lot of that was probably rose-colored glasses, which that means that somebody was dead in the scene. And I don't necessarily like a lot of M. Night's shtick, because I think he got a little too full of himself after Sixth Sense and just kept doing the same thing over and over again. Split, I think McAvoy runs that movie really well. I like Anna Scout Joy. I think she was really good in it. But a lot of it, I think, was just a lot of crap. And I think it was made better by a great performance by a great actor. But it really was the, I'm going to tell you all this thing, and at the last second, I'm going to tack on this other thing to make it seem a lot cooler, because it's attached to this other movie that I got a lot of praise for, and hopefully you all still like that shit. So I have a problem. I have a few problems with the film.
Well, there's a lot of bunk psychology in it.
Yeah, and
got a lot of bunk comic books in Unbreakable. All
yeah.
None of the comic book stuff in Unbreakable is authentic in any way.
At all.
So he's like both very self-important and completely off base and inauthentic at the same time. It must have been a humbling experience.
I kind of get really pissed off about people like M. Night and Quentin Tarantino and a lot of these Hollywood people who seem to think that they're comic book fans or know how to speak about comic books and have no fucking clue. I mean, you can say what you want about Kevin Smith as a director, as a writer, whatever. The guy fucking loves comics and has made comics and understands comics. All these other assholes come out there and they're just like, oh yeah, I get the genre and I can speak to it and everything. Fuck you, you can. You don't know shit.
Yeah, well, Kevin Smith trotted out like Mike Allred and like all kinds of other guys for the convention scene in Chasing Amy. And it made it so authentic and so credible. And, you know, and it was still funny. And here he's so confused about what he's making and what it is and everything they say. And it opens up with Wikipedia facts on comics.
Oh, yeah.
And its biggest sin is that it talks about comics as if it's a genre and not a medium.
Yep.
Over and over and over again.
Yeah.
So I mostly agree with Corey about Unbreakable, and I'm soft on Split 2, but I think for different reasons. In general, did you guys hear the story that John Krasinski's told last week where he was at the Globes or I don't know where he was, but apparently he's good friends with Paul Thomas Anderson through Maya Rudolph, I guess, or maybe his wife is. I'm not sure. But anyway, they go to dinner parties and stuff, and they were talking about a movie, and he's like, oh, I hated that movie. And then like a little few minutes later or something, Paul Thomas Anderson took him aside and goes, hey, man, I just want to let you know you should really never say you hate a movie as like a professional courtesy now that you're a director. You know, just you can have your opinions, but you really shouldn't talk shit about movies. And he says that was really opened his eyes, and he gets it because they've gotten bad reviews for their vision. Imagine putting all your hard work into something, and yeah, you're going to read the reviews, and you're going to know it's going to suck. But if you know somebody who knows somebody, it's a little more awkward, and especially if it's your occupation and it's hypocritical.
We do that when we play shows.
Yeah.
Sorry. But well, it's the same thing because
you don't tell the opening act how terrible they are.
No, and I also don't really tell someone I don't know very well my thoughts on the bands that we're playing with because we don't want to be those guys where it's like, yeah, they're really good, but they're dicks.
I personally try not to talk about or even listen to, but that goes hand in hand, like other Simpsons podcasts. Mm-hmm. I don't even. I'd like to think mine is better than at least most of them. But even if it was, I wouldn't want to. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So anyway, I've been trying to live with that philosophy more, even though I do a show that trashes a show and I'm on your show that trashes movies. I get it, but everything's with a grain of salt. None of this fucking matters at the end of the day. So I mostly agree with you guys about M. Night Shyamalan, but I was thinking while you guys were talking about him, imagine this guy. He's probably what, 27, 28, not even, when Sixth Sense just explodes. He'd been a screenwriter for a few years before Sixth Sense. He did like She's All That and stuff. I don't know how he got where he got, because he's very lucky even to get something like that. But anyway, Sixth Sense made him, you know, we're talking about his, everybody knows M. Night Shyamalan. That's a, yep. You know, there's 50 directors maybe that you'd know like a name like that. He's one of the top of all time. And it's from the first movie. And it's from, he's not even 30 years old yet. So imagine, I think you're right. I think it's his ego. I think he got a little too full of himself and people weren't checking him. And that's why the next few movies weren't so good. But maybe it's also part of this or all of this where he's just like this crippling, oh my God, I got to do another twist ending. If I don't do another twist ending, everybody's going to hate me. You know, you got all these studios, it must be the most stressful thing in the world to be like 30 years old, coming off Sixth Sense and doing a second film. Now he's been around, he's proven he can still make money and he's had enough disappointing movies where now he's probably much more relaxed as an artist. He knows none of this fucking matters. But I bet you for Unbreakable, which was the second one after Sixth Sense, that must have been the scariest shooting experience of his life.
And it didn't do particularly well. It got increased interest later on, but it didn't make what Sixth Sense made, or I think even close. It was not considered the success. But I still think that there was a heart to it. Mm-hmm. And it felt like it was both true to his voice. It's one of those things, like you see an M. Night movie, you know it's an M. Night movie, unless it's Last Airbender or something. But
well, even in that one, he uses all the same motifs. It's all elemental stuff and water stuff. And
oh, yeah,
he also doesn't know anything about the characters or the subject that he's writing on.
Last Airbender breaks my heart. I saw the movie well before I knew anything about the show. I thought that literally he airbended by it was a kung fu movie. From based on the trailer, and that like when he kicked, he could kick so hard that it would like throw a wave of like shot, like a shock wave. That's what I thought I was walking into. I forget how, but eventually I watched the series years after I see the movie, and I think it's one of the greatest modern. I think it's like I should be up there with Star Wars in terms of like expanded universe and fantasy and stuff like that. I think it's brilliant, and I think the sequel series is even more brilliant. So that really blows my mind that the movie is as bad in retrospect. Like I saw the movie, it's like, oh, a bad movie. Now it's like, how do you whiff that? And it was fairly faithful to the show too. So I don't know. Maybe he's just not a good director. I don't think,
remember people coming out of the movie and saying you couldn't even say the main character's name right. Like, how do you do that? Of all things, how do you not have them say the character's name correctly? It's not like there was a ton of source material. But yeah, so what I was going to say is that M. Night's style, stylistically, you can look at a movie and know that he's the one who did it. You can look at a Tarantino film. You can look at a Tim Burton movie. So nothing to take away from what his accomplishments are, but I think he fell into the same thing that Lucas did, which is that at some point he didn't have people that he could actually trust and listen to say, hey, you know, take this in another direction, or he just stopped asking for directives. Or whatever. I don't know. But I got to a point where I just was tired of his shtick. And it's okay if it's your one note jam and that's all you ever do and you get continued success with it, that's great. But I think at some point people want to stop hearing the same Bon Jovi album and over again and they want to get a new sound. And he didn't come up with a new sound until he basically started having failures in films. And people got tired of that. And I appreciate that he worked his way back to getting into the zeitgeist of people's views and stuff. And like when Split happened, but all I remember is everybody coming out of Split and saying, oh my God, that ending. Oh my God, that ending, not talking about the ending of the story, but the tacked on bit of the connection to the other thing.
Yeah.
And I think that's a pretty bad way to rate a movie.
And do you think people were generally, besides film buffs and guys like us, do you think, and women like us, do you think that people were genuinely like the general audiences, because Split was a pretty mainstream hit, gave a shit or even knew what was happening when Bruce Willis with the name Dunn, so they have to remember David Dunn from Unbreakable, that most people didn't see when it was out and it was 18 years ago. So most people were like, if I was the age I was saw Unbreakable now, I wouldn't know what Unbreakable was. And like, do you think people are like, what? Mr. Glass, David Dunn's back. Stop the presses.
Right. I think a few
people. Luke Skywalker's Darth Vader's son, David Dunn and Mr. Glass are in Split. What?
Well, all of the news coverage was very matter of fact. It wasn't like, you may not remember this 20-year-old movie. It was the reveal was that they were, it was teased after Unbreakable that there was a universe of movies coming.
Well, it wasn't a universe because there was no such thing as
or
a
whatever,
universe.
Or whatever. But
it was supposed to be a trilogy. It was, right. Yeah. And like, I really like, yeah.
The greatest of all film achievements.
I liked Unbreakable when I saw it in the theater. And, you know, I was 15, 16. I was just thinking, I didn't realize it was that far back. I remember seeing it with Dan. So that means that's one of the movies where either my mother or his mother dropped us off. And I think it was PG-13, but it was R. They would have to get in line. And Dan's mother would go, I'd like to buy rated R tickets for my son and his friends. And like, we're doing this in front of kids who are slightly like 1 or 2 years older than us that don't have to go through that. It was humiliating. And Unbreakable was one of those films. And I liked it when it came out. And I was excited because I was like, okay, that was kind of boring. But season two, the second movie and the third movie are going to be amazing. You know, I don't like origin stories for the most part. They might be the most satisfying of movie arcs, but I know what's coming. Like Heroes, the NBC show, I never liked it. And I just like season one was so boring. And I was just like, all right, once we get to season two and everybody has their full powers, not knowing that would never happen because of, creative issues and the fact that you can't have everybody have their powers because of budgets and. But I always think the beginning, the origin star is the most boring. I can't wait for the sequels. I can't wait for Avengers 2, 3, Spider-Man 2.
It's a promise that's never fulfilled.
Exactly. So I was very excited to get this trilogy. Eventually, I was like, okay, they're never happening. And then, I was almost disappointed that this is how the sequel is coming. But at the same time, I'm super pumped. We're getting a Mr. Glass movie. I don't care if it's good. I don't care if it's bad. I'm just curious to see it.
Mr. Glass.
So his character is probably the thing that I like the least in Unbreakable. Someone else was playing that character and bringing them to life in a less schmaltzy way with less like on the nose production color design choices.
It was very dumbed down. Yeah.
It's really weird. The one thing there's two things I like that he does. Okay. So all the comic book stuff sucks except for the handwritten note. The one in the car,
which is the only thing I've missed, by the way. That was the one time
only like comic book thing that has any kind of authenticity. The lettering font on how he does some of those letters is like a classic comics font.
But so this, like Corey said, this was happening right at the very start of the modern comic book movement. It was after Blade and probably X-Men, and that's about it. Yeah. And do you think you have to dumb down the color schemes and everything because movie audiences aren't acquainted with the comic book style, or is that, or if
no, I think that M. Night had done that with the color red in The Sixth Sense. And so every time he would do a shot, like when Dunn is in the whole like space where he's touching people, you see the color of that person's jacket is very expressive. So you see a red jacket and then their red is the only thing that you see in the next scene of them exposing what their dark secrets are. You see a yellow one, you see this one. And so the purple with glass is obviously the very stark contrast, but it shows that he's been a villain the whole time because he's always been in that kind of color scheme. And it's those extreme color schemes that kind of show that these are the bad people.
Yeah. Yeah. I think
that's an artistic choice. My problem that I look back at this last night as I'm rewatching it for the first time in years is, holy shit, is Elijah the shitty ass comic book fan that you're not a good enough fan in his eyes? You do not deserve to say you're a comic fan. Is he the fake comic girl guy? Because when that guy's trying to buy a piece of art for his kid and he's like, no, get the fuck out of here. How many fucking times do you and your gallery have a chance to sell a priceless piece of comic history to somebody and then give yourself the moment and say, no, fuck you. You don't buy this for your 4-year-old. What's this 4-year-old going to do? Make a paper airplane out of it? Who the fuck cares? Take the sale. You're going to break something. You need insurance. I got to imagine that you're not easy to cover. Fucking take it. And I just was like, fuck, this guy does not give a shit about comic books at all.
My favorite parts of Podcast of Terror is when Corey goes on a capitalist rant.
It happens.
You earn that dollar. You earn that buck. He would totally be the face of like Gamergate now. So I'm curious, based on what I've seen in the Glass trailers, I don't think I've ever. This was the first time I've watched this movie in full since maybe college. I think I saw it once after the theater, but maybe since the theater. And there was a lot of things I forgot about. And I didn't remember Mr. Glass's way of talking. Like, it's almost autistic. Like, the very over-eloquent and he works his way around. And it, does the child need a tissue or something like that? You know, like, not even talking to the child as if it's there. And I didn't get that sense in the very few things I've seen in the Glass trailer. In the Glass trailer, I feel like it was just Samuel L. Jackson being Samuel. Like, he goes, looks like the bad guys are teaming up. Like, I don't see Mr. Glass in this movie saying something like that. He would say something like, it appears that there will be a union, an alliance of the
character superhero. Is so jazzed that there's other superhero morons to hang out with for a movie. Superman.
Also, like, wasn't the whole point of Unbreakable was like, wow, we have a superhero now? And like,
yeah. Can you tell me how it went? I didn't see the last 20 minutes.
Of what? Unbreakable?
Unbreakable.
Oh, come on. That's the best part.
This is what I think happens based on the one.
Wait, so where did you leave off before you tell us what you think?
He's like, it's like he's wearing his fucking awesome looking hood cape.
Yeah, his poncho.
He's wearing his great poncho. It looks like a great superhero costume.
It's a rainproof. It's a rain jacket. It's literally his armor against rain, against water, his weakness.
So I think he gets in a pool, like the tarp of a pool, and he's gonna drown.
You turn it off there in the most exciting scene in the movie?
Or no, before that. This is just what I remember. I hate this movie so much. I really.
That's like watching Avengers, and then Thanos snaps, and you're like, I've seen what I need to do. All right. I'm sure everybody
feel better. I didn't even get to Thanos snapping in the Avengers.
So you stopped at the end, Ben. You didn't miss much. Basically, the kids save him, pull him out of the water because that's his weakness. He's drowning.
Because they're all heroes together. He lifts up their reaching hands.
I just want to give Matt a moment to say what you missed. I'm going to spoil it for you. Is Thanos snaps and then it turns into a whole thing of "You Can't Hurry Love," the Phil Collins cover. Thanos just sings it with, like, song. Four other Thanos is singing around him and stuff. It was beautiful.
I wish that would be kind of amazing. It'll probably be better than the Endgame. Yeah, so the kids save him with a pool skimmer. He kills the guy. He literally chokes the bad guy to death. The parents are both dead. He saved the two kids. And then the next day is the first day he wakes up and he's not sad anymore. And he shows his son the newspaper headline that says, "Masked hooded hero saves children. Nobody knows who he is." And he's just like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, you remember. You watched.
Don't forget that he also heals his marriage from it. It's that moment of he picks up his sleeping wife and drags her up to his bedroom.
Which is a weird cut from him, like, lifting up the dead body of the dead mom. It was very weird. But
their dynamic is really there's some rich stuff in there.
We'll get there. But it's a happy ending, and you think it's the start of a superhero, and it was supposed to be the first of a trilogy. So I was depressed. At the end of Split, it looks like he's unless he's still that's his secret identity. But clearly in Glass, he's been in a mental hospital for a while, so that's no fun.
I don't know if he's been in a mental hospital for a while. From what I'm gathering from the previews, it seems that they all wind up there. But obviously, so Ben, you don't even know what that Glass is the villain from the first movie.
Glass.
Yeah.
He realizes he did all the bombings looking for somebody who would survive. He blew up the plane, he blew up the train. He started the fire.
Those miraculous words in perfect. There's definitely an autism element to it. I think that he plays it too dapper. Like he should really just be a guy in the street with long boxes.
Well, let me.
You're right. He's got the suits and the glasses.
Yeah. Let's take a step back. Remember 1999 when this movie came out? What were the popular things of superheroes? Was Batman Begins out yet? Because that's another superhero origin story. And the villain is very like, but we had Michael Rosenbaum playing Lex Luthor on Smallville, and Michael Rosenbaum would just walk into a room and start quoting Nietzsche or Sun Tzu or some bullshit to get himself in the conversation. He just comes in, philosophizes for a second, and then like goes back out to being, is he a bad guy? Is he not a bad guy? I mean, I know he's Lex Luthor, but is he a bad guy? And it was a lot of stuff like that. It was the villain had to be smarter than the hero, had to prophesize to the hero a lot, and were they a bad guy? Were they not a bad guy? And it made them kind of this like line walking thing. And so Glass, we don't realize is the bad guy until it's revealed what he's done, but he still sees himself as noble as to making it happen. He does acknowledge that he's the arch villain to David Dunn, but he does it in such a way like this was his mission in life, is to find this hero, to bring this hero to fruition for the world. And so he went through villainous ways to do it, but he sees himself being the part of the reason why there is a hero in the first place.
Do you think he doesn't see himself as a supervillain?
No, he does.
Okay.
My favorite part is his car. Is his car. It looks so comfortable.
It looks very comfortable. Man, he must have made a lot of money selling comics.
Yeah, and that's another thing. He's hanging out in that comic store later on.
Yeah.
And he's just sitting there, and he doesn't fucking realize, oh, a superhero has a weakness, until he sees the cover of a comic and remembers. But then you look in the back of his art gallery later, and you see just walls and walls of fucking comics. Like, you have something in there where the hero has a weakness. In one of those fucking issues, you had to go comatose in the back of a comic store and piss off some guy. I felt that because I've managed about 3 different comic stores in my life.
Did we lose Corey?
He freezes once in a while.
He literally uses the word kryptonite at one point.
That's weird. And also they rip off the Action Comics font.
Well, that's fine. I don't mind. I get what they're doing. They can't use Action Comics, but
they should have just gotten the license. If they're going to say kryptonite, they might as well be like...
Who released it? Disney released this. This is a Disney movie, and they certainly aren't going to get Warner Brothers IP, but the fact that he knows what kryptonite is means like the weakness is it's not like an obscure super comic book thing. He should have already been thinking on all the times he was looking for a hero that the hero would have a weakness.
That's because Shyamalan doesn't know anything about comics. Like, that's all. He doesn't know anything.
He read Wikipedia. You didn't see the openings. There are so many.
With Google search results.
But no, you're right. He shortcutted the dialogue. He wants to tell the audience, oh, this is the thing that I'm talking about, but he shortcuts it while saying, I didn't know about this thing. So surprisingly, there's an issue of a comic that I remembered. Oh, yeah, they look for the weakness of all the superheroes. I couldn't just say to you, it's kryptonite, the word that I'm about to give you in the following breath.
Yeah, no, the writing in this, and I think in Split, is very bad. I think M. Night Shyamalan struggles as a. It's funny that he is a writer-director. I think he would be much more successful as a director. I think he's a great director. I just don't think he's a great screenwriter. And he narrative and structure he's not bad with, but dialogue is very bad, and he's not great directing actors. And Split has the same problem with just you know movies need exposition, but it's very clunky in his films. It's and like I hate the fake way people talk. That really bothers me. Unless you're stylistic like Tarantino and that's the point. But I hate when you're trying to sound like more naturalistic, and by doing that you sound even worse. Like so the opening of Split is like the way the kids talk with the dad, and like it's just everybody sounds like they grew up in like Aaron Sorkin's house. And I never buy, especially with teenagers, and especially with that's why I don't know if the autistic thing is on the page or if that was Samuel, because I think Samuel L. Jackson can be a very hammy actor as well. So I don't know if that was an acting choice or if it was on the page, but it probably was on the page where like M. Night Shyamalan, he can't think of an eccentric character that doesn't speak 100% eccentrically. There's no gray areas for him when it comes to that kind of stuff.
Well, the other thing is, I think screenwriting has taken this shtick of every movie that we do that's supposed to have some dramatic reveal towards the end is we give you a line early on and then we repeat it at the end. You know, why do we fall? So we learn to get back up, Bruce. It's the same bullshit concept done over and over again in superhero movies. It's like, here's this thing, this message that we just hinted at earlier, and here's that same message coming back, and now you have that click of realization. And it's like, okay, I fucking get it, but is that all that Hollywood can do with these movies anymore? Is that all every writer does?
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up Nolan, because I was thinking exactly of Christopher Nolan when you're talking about M. Night Shyamalan just doing the same Bon Jovi album over and over, because Nolan and Shyamalan are very similar directors. Every one of their movies is basically the same, you know, with it's different in very superficial ways. They have a formula and they have a pattern that they stick to both. It's mostly visual and emotional. I think Nolan's a slightly better writer, but also he doesn't write his own scripts. Usually he has co-writers.
Yeah.
I think that's important. And maybe Nolan's probably a stronger filmmaker. So, but what's funny is Nolan has not had a single bomb. He has hit every single time. Prestige was a hit. Batman Begins was a hit. Inception, even Interstellar was like, you know, it didn't do as well as people wanted, and Dunkirk didn't get the Oscars people thought, but they do all right. And critically they do all right. Even when people go, it was okay, they never trash it. And, you know, Shyamalan had a dud right out of the gate, after Sixth Sense with Unbreakable. Village wasn't very well received, and Lady in the Water was really just tanked. Signs got mixed. I love Signs, my favorite Shyamalan film. But he didn't have the momentum Nolan ever. Imagine Nolan's like the first or second Batman movie tanked, and like Nolan had Shyamalan's career.
Yeah. By the way, Joaquin Phoenix was supposed to play McAvoy's character in Split.
Really? He was supposed to play Doctor Strange too. I think I would like that better. I think James McAvoy does a good job, but I don't think he does a great job. I don't know how you can do a bunch of personalities, especially like an old woman and a kid, without seeming very hammy. There might not be a way to do it. I haven't seen Sally Field's Split Personality movie, but it's inherently kind of actory thing to do. But there was a couple of his Barry, or actually I guess it's his the other guy pretending to be Barry. I thought he actually did a really good. I don't know. Like, it's to me, it sounds like a New York accent. I know he's in Philly, but the Barry character is my cousin. Like, was a very specific, like, type of person that I just immediately was like, oh, he's turned into that character. Whereas when he was the little kid, it was like James McAvoy's playing a little kid.
The little kid was rough. The little kid was hard to buy into. Phyllis character I liked a lot.
Yeah, I think Joaquin Phoenix might have maybe done a better job. And I think McAvoy did a good job. But I think that would have been interesting with Phoenix. And he's just creepier.
Well, so here's Beatmaster's calling us out in the chat. The water is the weakness again. So here's one of my things is, do we believe at this point that the reveal, the final scene of whatever this fucking movie Glass is going to be, is going to be the reveal that Dunn and McAvoy's character got their powers from the aliens because of the same weakness. I believe that for years. I've always believed that David Dunn's powers must come from the aliens that come from Signs.
I like that a lot, and I wish I didn't know that, because if that had happened, I probably would have been like, oh my God. So Split was spoiled for me too. Nobody told me that Dunn was in it, but like I was already seeing the articles, like, could Unbreakable, could there be a sequel between Unbreakable and Split? I didn't know there was a specific reference, but I already had the two movies in my head together because of that. So when it came, I was like, okay, that makes sense. And I would have loved to have known what my reaction to David Dunn being. I think I would have really been excited if I saw David Dunn and had no idea he was coming. Because again, I am a big Unbreakable. I haven't seen it, but I have it has a place in my heart. I think it's a cute film.
No, I think going back to the 20 years ago that it happened, I was very excited when I came out of that of like, holy shit, I can't believe what this movie was, because it subverted my expectations of what I was walking into when I saw it. And I thought there was a lot there that was very promising, but in a world when we didn't have other superhero movies that were doing well. And certainly we've had the gamut run of like high-end super movies, low-end super movies. This wasn't Steel. It wasn't Catwoman, but it wasn't Winter Soldier, which is one of my favorites. On the other hand, we've also seen the Marvel thing happen so much that we kind of can tear apart the Marvel movies real easily now and know, you know, did they achieve? Did they not achieve? Are they just doing the same thing over and over again? But I felt, at least because one, it was very new to me. It was only Shyamalan's second film, and it was new in the sense that we didn't have a lot of other great superhero films. We'd already gone through, I think, Clooney's Batman, it was like, okay, this is kind of a breath of fresh air. But the other part of it is that he wrote Unbreakable because he didn't want to do a whole superhero movie. He felt like he was more interested in the origin story than the whole other thing. He like had taken the superhero journey and decided that the origin story was the most interesting part. Then he did a supervillain origin story in Split. What if he's not capable of doing anything past the origin? Yeah. What if he can't make these two characters or three characters meet up in a way that is actually interesting? Because every time I see the commercials for Glass, it's McAvoy's character jumping through the ground like some sort of beast thing, which is inherent to what his character is supposed to be, but it looks really bad.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
a beast.
The beast. Yeah, and that's the other thing that's confusing.
Or the Horde.
Who's the supervillain? The Horde or the beast?
Horde.
Right.
Pick one.
And also, my psychiatrist doctor doesn't recognize that I could possibly have a 24th personality. Oh, yeah, you've got all these 23 personalities bumping around and knocking into each other and shit and sending me emails and stuff. But there's no fucking way there's a 24th one. You dumb bitch, you deserve to die.
So I want to take a quick moment here. In your chat there, Beatmaster says, it won't be the aliens that give them their powers. It'll be the plant life. Nice little reference to The Happening, which again, I don't hate Shyamalan. The Happening is a terrible movie, but like
when I watch it,
there's things I like about it. And even the things I don't like, I like that I don't like about it. Like Mark Wahlberg's terrible in the movie, but I kind of like it. Like I like how terrible he is, and I like the way he's terrible.
I can't watch it. I can't watch any of the, like, I after The Village.
Yeah,
I was just like, I'm not watching anymore. And Wahlberg is definitely not ever going to be something that draws me towards a film.
I was very disappointed in The Village because I guessed the twist ending halfway through. And then, like, the same thing is with Prestige. I've never seen Prestige since the theater, and everybody tells me I got to rewatch it, and I'm going to rewatch it. But I hated it because right away I realized what the twist was going to be. And then
right.
And the point of the movie isn't the twist, and that's a problem. That's why you always end up liking.
Twist, man. Prestige.
Also, Matt, I sent you those photos. I sent you three photos.
I saw them.
Yeah, I don't know if you wanted to share them with the screen there, but it's me and Ben.
It's up to you if you want me to.
Well, that's why I sent them to you rather than that's why I screenshotted them and cut out all the other stuff. But it's me and Ben. 16 years ago this month, because that was when I got my first ever digital camera. The one is of our door, and like the jokes are hilarious because we thought this was the funniest thing. We said we put the Ween in Halloween. The joke was supposed to be that Ween doesn't mean anything. It wasn't a reference to the band. And we just thought that kind of nonsense humor was so fucking funny. See, that's not really Guido me though, because already my hair's out and I bleached blonde my thing, and I got I switched from a silver chain to a rope, like a $3 rope.
I really like Ben's Raiders sweatshirt though.
It does look like you pushed the little daisies and made them come up though.
Get it.
and then the door.
What's going on?
And like, so like,
we're
yeah, and
pictures of you on the internet.
And then we have the St. Patrick's Day. We did a St. Patrick's Day thing. We thought it'd be like, what's, you know, we thought a dinosaur would be funny because that's not Irish. But I do love Ben's drawings. Ben has a great aesthetic. And then for Halloween, we put Super Mario, RoboCop, and Raphael. And we're like, who are three non-Halloween characters? But that's such an inherently stupid idea because it's Halloween. Everybody's a Halloween character because you dress up as them for Halloween. So none of our jokes were funny. We were the M. Night Shyamalan of dorm door jokes.
Of life, really.
Of life. We're the M. Night Shyamalans of life. The twist ending is, this is it. So here's my notes for the movies, because I like how you guys dance around, but it's very hard for me to.
No, I thought about taking notes, and I'm like, no, Jack is going to do that.
So I want to talk about the beginning, the comic book facts being listed in Unbreakable. Sure. I thought that was very unnecessary. You don't need that. You don't need that. I don't know why he would choose to do that. And then at the end of the movie, they do like freeze frames. It's like Mr. Glass was sentenced to 18 years, like the end of the People's Court. It's like David Dunn was awarded $7,000 in damages. He will have to pay the lawyer's fees, you know, stuff like that. And I don't know if that was that was Shyamalan. What the fuck are you doing? First of all, you only see that in movies when it's a true story. You know, like Goodfellas, you find out that Henry Hill was sentenced to 17 years and is now in witness protection. You don't do that with fake movies.
Now known as Senator Blukowski or whatever.
Yeah. You don't have to do that. You know, unless it's a comedy. But I was thinking maybe the studio maybe made him do that because they were like, it's not clear that Mr. Glass gets away with it or something like that. Because Dunn basically just walks away, and it's like, is he gonna get him arrested? Is he gonna call him out? Is he gonna just let it go? You know, so maybe the studio made him do that to dumb it down. So that's my first note. My second note is Bruce Willis, 2000. This is one of his first bald people where he shaved his head, and he's now like, you know, grizzled, sad Bruce Willis, which started with Sixth Sense. But I didn't realize that he was still so young looking in the beginning of that new phase. Like, he really looks young there. It's crazy.
Well, this kid's not that old.
No, I know. And, it's scary to think that I'm older than probably the first three John McClanes at this point, or at least around at least the first couple. We already mentioned the clunky. Oh, here, this little House of Cards trivia. There's four actors from House of Cards in this movie. You have
Robin Wright.
The doctor at the very beginning, which is one of my favorite scenes, where he's like, trying to figure out how Bruce Willis doesn't have a scratch on him. That's Michael Kelly, who is the second lead in House of Cards, third after Kevin Spacey. And he is also, he's a great character actor. He's I know a lot of actors who know him. He's just been working his ass off for a couple of decades now. I fell in love with him in the Dawn of the Dead remake. He's like the hick mall guard that is like a total asshole, but then turns out to be one of the best characters in the movie. So he's great. Then you have the guy in the fatigue jacket that gets out of line when they start padding for guns. He is he's the hacker in House of Cards. He's like he hacks the election basically. And he starred on the comeback with Lisa Kudrow, and I saw him in a very bad mood with his wife and daughter on the R train about a year ago, which I'll never forget. And then there was a fourth one. Oh, the killer at the end. He was one of the bodyguards. He was one of the Secret Service agents. So a little weird four House of Cards superfecta there. Oh, I had a question for you, Matt. So I remember one of the scenes I remember is when he's bench pressing and they keep adding the paint cans and he just keeps going. And they're making such a big deal out of like, holy shit, he can just keep doing it. And then at the end, when he's lifting all of the weights and all of the paint cans, he's like, how much is that? And he goes, 350. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. 350 is a lot, but that's not superhuman, right? There's people that can do 350.
Yeah. I the most I've ever benched is 335.
So you came almost as close as a superhero.
Yes. But our friend of the show, previous guest, Matt Vincent, has benched damn near 500.
So why is it such a big deal that it's 350?
I think it's just because he's a small guy and he's
He's not a professional bodybuilder. He's not someone who's doing a lot of lifting normally, and he was surprised that he did 250. So to go from 250 to adding another 100 pounds and still being able to do it and not really feeling, it seems like the resistance that he felt was the same at the 250 was the 350. That it was probably all mental.
Well, realistically, in a grounded film.
He's never living up to his own potential. Yeah.
I would, like, that works in a grounded film, but I just feel like it has to be more cinematic than that.
It didn't seem to make a ton of sense, like, kind of like you said.
That much. Maybe it's not supposed to be that much. Like, you are supposed to remain a little skeptical about.
Okay,
and what's within the realm of reality.
But they do make it such a heroic moment.
What? Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's because he's like a schmaltzy, overselling, you know.
Yeah,
a guy who has spent his years trying to pretend that he was subject to a bad injury, so that he doesn't have the physicality that he had when he was in college. So it's both a surprise to him because it's like while I don't believe it, the thing about him, when's the last time you called in sick to work or whatever, and him having to go through all this rigmarole to figure out if he's ever been sick. It's like, fucking dude, I know if I've been sick or not.
Yeah, and I know, and I at least know my sick days, because every time I take a sick day, it's like, you know, it's money out of my goddamn check.
Yeah, and he's only lived in that house for like 3 years, so you'd know if you took a sick day in that 3 years' time.
Yeah.
Weird choices.
Speaking of weird choices, how about like the fact that, so they worked very hard on the score. They wanted to come up with a very memorable score. I don't think they did. I think the split score is better. But what
there
I
there were love, points in the split score where I thought it was this score used again, though.
It may have been. This was much more strings, and I remember split was a lot of piano, but it was very subdued, which is what made it really funny that the very beginning of the film, and then when he becomes the superhero and he's in the station and he's like touching everybody, they play this like funky 90s beat that was, you know, only popular. Like I've rewatched the Rocky fight scenes recently, and I forgot that the fight scene in Rocky 5 has this like 90s hip hop beat to it the whole time, which is ridiculous. It's like, wow, and like, and, you know, and it was like that MTV style, like crooked zoom ins. And anyway, so I was very surprised. I mean, it fits 1999, 2000. It fits the time period, but this serious, grounded, unbreakable, you know, this sad, somber, rainy superhero film starring grizzled Bruce Willis. And the soundtrack's like, and then I realized at the end of Split, it comes back too. When they introduce Bruce Willis again, that you know, a Split just has this haunting ending. She's going back to her rapist uncle or whatever. And the split soundtrack fades away, and then all of a sudden, Unbreakable, you know,
the Unbreakable rap.
Yeah, exactly. That would be the opening to Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt or whatever.
Yeah, my name is Glass, and I'm here to say,
put that fucking comic down. Yeah, first of all, never watch the movie Lady Hawk. If you grew up within the 80s, we were very forgiving of that soundtrack behind the scenes of this otherwise beautiful fantasy film with Rutger Hauer and Michelle Pfeiffer. But it's really tough to watch and listen to that music in the background now. we had a different period where we accepted a lot of shit like that. And
the 90s
and I think,
were terrible.
Yeah, it's funny. I look at pictures of me in high school. I'm like, what was I fucking thinking? But in that moment, it seems okay. And it's hard to create something that's timeless. And I worry about that. It's like watching Labyrinth for the first time in the 2000s if you didn't see it in the 80s. And you're like, why are so many people so into this movie? It's an okay movie, but it doesn't work unless you grew up with it. And I think that there are things that you just kind of look at and you can tear apart. Like, who made this decision? Who thought this was okay? It's like, well, every fucking Matrix movie ends with Rage Against the Machine. Every Transformers movie ends with Linkin Park. It just for some reason, the signatures get a little bit overloaded on these things.
Yeah,
I don't know who signed the contract.
I always wonder if, like, what in 20 years, like, if I try to shoot a film and make it look like a 70s film, I can do that. You know, the Starsky and Hutch colony did that. Or if you want to try to make something look like the 90s, 90s style, or something look like a 50s, or the artist looked like it was made in the 1930s. And I always wonder, like, what will the spoof, if you're playing up the artistic tendencies of the 2000s, what would it be? And I think maybe, although pop culture has slowed down since the 90s because of the internet and stuff. So now 10 years of fashion lasts 15 or 20. But I think the movies with like the last 19 years or so are like Unbreakable, where they're over self-serious, you know, and the bomb and the... And right now we just kind of like, yeah, all these movies are self-serious. But I wouldn't be surprised if like that becomes a hallmark of this decade or so of types of movies and music and stuff. You know, even our music is all very minor key and like sad pop. And I would be very curious. I would be funny if in like 2040 people are like, oh, we're going to do a retro vintage 2010 superhero movie where everybody's sad. It's always raining.
Yeah.
I could see them doing that.
I love that story.
which story? Oh, this shitty slow motion in the movie surprised me too. You ever see like the really choppy slow motion where they like everything gets blurry when it gets slow?
Like Unsolved Mysteries.
Yeah, and Lethal Weapon did it a lot. That's because they didn't film it in slow motion. They did it in post, and there's not enough frames to really keep the image clear because you're stretching each frame out. And that means they didn't script it to be slow motion. They came up with it in editing. And I just, you'd think M. Night Shyamalan, who storyboards everything and he's got the whole movie in his head. You would, I don't know why they chose to do slow motion scenes in post. And they, I don't know, that's a, I guess, film school jack. That drives me nuts when I see that.
That's a fair call out. I mean, it's not something that I would pick up on because I don't have the education of filmmaking that you do, but you're right. It is one of those things that just to watch it and see that it does take you out a little bit. And the fact that it seems like it couldn't have been.
Yeah.
That it was a missed thing as opposed to like just a mistake.
Yeah, I it's not something I teach you in film school, I don't think. I noticed it enough times and then I finally put two and two together because I knew how slow motion works. But you could always, like, I remember, you know, I grew up with the Lethal Weapon movies and I was always like, why is this slow motion scene so choppy? You know, it was almost an aesthetic of the Lethal Weapon series because Donna used it so much. Well, by the way, I made Ben in college when we lived together sit down and watch all four Lethal Weapon movies.
It's true.
Yeah.
At what point between three and four did he stab you?
he cried during three, I think. I think he cried with the boat scene.
I haven't seen any of them since. So
I made my
point. You guys make an impression on me.
Here's something.
Many tears.
Here's something that's funny. It's a note I have. When he's in the train station and he's feeling for all the crimes. And he finally, you know, sees a guy, a murderer, and he goes after him. But I like that before that, he sees a guy that's raping women and a racist person who's like smashing glass. And he's like, I'll let them go this time.
Right. Yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, that's not violent enough for me. I can definitely see. And I almost want to say like he was turning towards the rapist guy.
Yeah.
He was going towards him. And then the other guy like got between him and him.
I could accept that.
But yeah, I thought about that too. It's like, okay, yeah, you lifted a jewel out of the case, lady. That's one thing. And then it got progressively worse. But that was a moment of like, that motherfucker needs to get hit or knocked around a little bit in front of the train. Something.
Break his like crush his genitals with your super strength.
Well, but we don't want to ruin his whole life. I mean, he's got a sports career ahead of him. We don't want him to suffer because of mistake.
Pop one testicle. With your super,
I'm glad that judge got called out. Fuck that judge.
you'd think a security guard, he's a security guard for a living. I feel like he had the total element of surprise on the killer at the end, and he puts him in this like really like tough chokehold with a guy that guy almost breaks out of. There's got to be an easier way to knock somebody out, right? Like, or just bop him on the head. I don't know.
Head, back of the head.
Yeah.
He's new to this stuff.
No, that fucking. He's new to this stuff. He calls Elijah to get advice. He's like, well, what do we do now? He's like, well, now you got to go test this shit out. It's like, hey, we just discussed how your weakness is water. Go out on a fucking rainy night, dumb shit. I could see Dunn making that mistake himself because he's not bright, but then Elijah to lead him toward it too. Like, maybe today's not your day.
Bring an umbrella.
Fucking
the
hell.
Penguin has it. The Penguin uses umbrellas.
And how would you feel if you were the kids who were just rescued by this guy and then you have to walk down and say, he fell into a fucking covered pool and can't swim his way out? You know what? I think we're okay with the murderer. I think the guy who killed my parents was probably the better choice.
That's scary. I don't know. If you fall in a tarp, you know,
it's terrifying.
Yeah, I can't swim either. And that scene really gets to me. Drowning freaks me the fuck out.
But you know, you got to be telling the newspaper people the next day. So someone just came in and randomly saved you? Well, yeah, but I wouldn't say he was good at it. You know, he just
don't
kinda,
thank me. Thank the pool skimmer.
I don't know if he was just a cable guy who came in because he didn't seem to know what the fuck he was doing at all. And then, so here's another thing that I'm kind of questioning. You're supposedly invulnerable and super strong. No body weight? Because when the murderer is... he's trying to choke the guy out. He's just getting thrown around the fucking room, just slamming into the walls and shit. Like he has fucking Longshot's bones from the X-Men who had bird bones. So they were hollow. Like he's just like getting tossed left and right and keep and hold. Sure. That's great. But like you have the ability to use more than just your arm strength at that point. You can pull back. You can do anything else. And it's like, I'm just going to tuck it in and see what happens. Like, what if that guy had then just jumped out the window and taken you back to the pool again?
That's what he should have done. Like, you know, like Bowser, you have to throw him into three different bombs. But yeah, that's exactly. He's a security guard. He should know how to subdue somebody. But I mean, that's a plot hole in a movie full of plot holes. Those are my notes. Those are all the notes I had for Unbreakable. I don't know if you guys had any as well.
this movie fucking sucks.
But did you write it down, Ben? Is it
was that a note?
So me and Corey clearly are team unbreakable here. So let's talk about Split, because you guys seem to like it more. Do you think it's a successful film? Do you think it sets out what it's trying to do and is good at it?
Financially, it was the most successful film of the year, right?
Yeah. Was it?
Yeah. It
well, it's cost, a Blumhouse. Yeah,
it cost $9 million to make, and it made $100 million. So as far as profitability goes, it landed.
Yeah, I forgot that it was a Blumhouse. Fucking Jason Blum, man. I was had that same idea. I mean, I'm sure lots of people had that same idea. It's like, look, give me $1 million. I will make you 10 films for $100,000. I'm hoping one of them with my talent will be good and make $1 million back. It's such a genius business model. It blows my mind that he's the only one that the first one to be successful with it.
I'm kind of both bummed out that everything now in horror seems to be coming from Blumhouse. But I'm also very grateful, even if I don't like a lot of their output. There's certainly things that we've talked about and had issues with here, or I have at least. But I do love the fact that they're doing it. You know, they're
getting made. He's making movies, and it's not just horror. He's done some art house films and some thrillers and dramas.
Well, some of his art house films are trying to be horror movies.
Right. But it doesn't matter, because the whole model is, you know, we're going to give you 50 movies. One of them will be good. There's got to be a good one in there. And he sticks to his budget. I read an article about, like, there's some J-Lo thriller he did, and he got a real, like, a legit director to do it. And the director's like, look, you got J-Lo, you got me. The movie's almost there. If we have this one big climax, it'll be a successful movie. I just need, like, $700,000 more to film it. He's like, no. It's like, no, literally, I'm telling you, it's like this small extra investment will make this movie a much better. It'll go from dud to hit. All I need is the extra money. No, but all I need is money. Because look, I don't make money by just going over budget every time. I have a hard rule. That's it. Use what you have. And he stuck to it, and the movie tanked. But it doesn't matter, because he didn't lose that extra $700,000 on any other films. And it's such a brilliant business model. I love it.
Well, agree with that. You don't dress up a turd and expect the turd to suddenly shine at the end.
Yeah, that's true. So Split's the most profitable. I think Split's enjoyable. I think it's good, but I don't know. I feel like I'm cooler on it than most people. I thought it was okay. I thought it could have been better.
The strength of that one performance is better than most of the stuff in all of his other movies.
You really think James McAvoy's that good?
The part where he's dancing as the kid is so fucking great.
But like, actors don't really get the opportunity to do a role like that, where you can switch around and do these broad stereotypes, but do a bunch of them in the same scene. I feel like, I don't know. I feel like the role, it's not easier to do, but it's easier to be praised. And I don't know if I bet you not just Phoenix, you could have like 10, 20, 30 actors in that role. And it would be such an interesting acting exercise that we would probably be saying the same thing about any of them.
That's fine, but he didn't fail, so he still deserves.
That's true. Okay. All right. Okay. I can buy
and 100% that scene where you see his little legs shoot up on the screen when he's doing the break dancing, and all you see is the legs come up. That is an adorable fucking moment.
Yeah. The break dance. Absolutely.
I don't know. I only got into a couple of the roles. They just seemed like they were good. They just seemed very two-dimensional to me.
What do you think about the flashbacks where Officer Piscatella is her uncle on the camping trip?
I'm so glad. I think I was video gaming with Matt, actually, or maybe it was with the other guys on our team. But at some point a couple weeks ago, I was like, what's that movie where Brad William Henke plays a rapist in the forest? And I couldn't think of it. I was like, oh, it's driving me nuts. And it was fucking Split.
And I kept yelling Deliverance at you. Yeah.
I don't think they were good. I don't think they were bad. I don't know. The whole where it leads to, I really don't like the idea of mental illness as a superpower. And I've certainly written stories like that in my emo years. I just, at one point, the Beast lets her go at the end, and he goes, broken is being evolved. And I think that's an irresponsible kind of philosophy to have, in terms of you don't want people thinking their depression and their psych, you know, their mental illnesses are actually attributes. Because I get the feeling that, it makes you feel different, and it makes you feel like you know, you get the world more than other people. I think that's an unhealthy idea to promote. But also, I think it's kind of lazy screenwriting. It's just like, look how different I'm being. I'm saying that the scars is what protects her. And that seems like that's something I wrote when I was 18. And M. Night Shyamalan's not 18. He's 40-something. He should be better than that. I don't know.
It's Marilyn Manson is a supervillain.
you're also you're kind of so he they make a comment where he says you are whatever you believe you are.
Yeah.
So you don't have to necessarily assume that it's a mental illness that caused Kevin to have 23, 24 personalities. He could have just believed he wanted to be 24 different people, and one was an amalgamation of animals that could get shot with buckshot four times.
But it's
the strength coming out of him because he's tired of being made fun of. Like, one of the personalities is tired of being teased and made fun of and hurt. A couple of the other personalities are tired of being let down, so they want something more powerful to manifest to give them the ability to rise to the top.
So I'm not saying you're incorrect. I do agree with what you're saying. I just think that there is probably another way you could look at it.
Sure, but I'm not talking about James McAvoy. I'm really talking more about Anna Steele-Joy, because that's what they do. They set up all these scenes that she's gone through this sexual assault and this trauma, and that's made her stronger. And that I can. All right, fine. It's a little exploitative, but yeah, sure. It's made her stronger. But the fact that he sees her scars and he goes, being broken is being more evolved. That's the kind of glorification of being depressed and being sad and being different.
Yeah, but you could also just say, like, having dealt with life makes you a stronger human.
But he doesn't know that. All he saw was that she cuts herself or has been attacked. That's all he's going on.
He sees her as not the weak. So there's this scene where they're talking about how the cheerleaders come up and they tease him and they have him put his hand on their breast and stuff, and they kind of draw him out, and it's a game to them. And that, I think, is part of the manifestation of the beast as well, is that he sees this, what is supposed to be purity and this easy life, and he says, those are the weak, those are the ones I want to destroy. But if he sees that you've suffered too, then that's who he's going to relate to, and that's the hard life that he's like, okay, so you're not like these two girls that I've been watching that are the perfect prey for the beast. You're like me. You're damaged. You understand pain. It's a shitty metaphor, but it's also kind of like Banky and Chasing Amy giving the excuse of, like, he says something that's really shitty, and later on Kevin Smith had to defend it to somebody saying, well, why do you say that in your film? He's like, well, I have the guy who's always wrong say it in the film. You know, so it's not like I'm saying this is the right message. Okay. It's a message of the character.
Yeah, that's what a moron says. So, you know.
I get it. So in universe, all of these themes do work, and there is a logic to them. I feel like M. Night Shyamalan is using that crutch of, it's in everything where the autism is superpower, and I don't know.
Autism is a superpower. But let me ask you this really important
question. It's not a superpower.
What happens in the last 25 minutes of the movie?
You missed the split? You missed the end of Split?
What the fuck, man?
Why don't you watch the ends and then just, like, cut out, like, 15 minutes of the middle, 20 minutes?
Guys, fuck off. Ben is 100% the most loyal fan of this show. He knows that Matt never finishes a fucking movie, never makes it all the way to the credits.
Don't put shit after the credits.
You have walked away from plenty of film where I've had to go back and say, but you missed this part.
Yeah. Well, the credits mean we're done.
Ben is the greatest pot fan ever.
Thanks, man.
That works on a couple of
things. Happens. Thomason, I like to call her Thomason because I can't remember her name. But I liked her in The Witch, so that's what I call her.
Anna Tyler?
Anna Cowjoy.
Anna Cowjoy. I liked her in The Witch.
Yeah, she's great in The Witch. I didn't even realize
that was her.
Yeah, I didn't realize it until after I IMDb'd it the first time I seen
this. She's gonna play Ilyana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. In what, The New Mutants?
Oh, The New Mutants. Yeah.
If it ever comes out, the movie was finished a year and a half ago. I collected
that series, Ben. I remember going down to my corner shop, getting all those issues when they were coming out, like praying that number 3 and number 4 would come out because it was taking forever. That Belasco series.
You know, I think that some of the casting for that New Mutants movie was really inspired, but I hope it never comes out, and I hope that the Black Dark Phoenix movie never comes out.
Well, the Dark Phoenix is definitely coming out. I don't know if New Mutants is real, but
false Marvel.
But also, they reshot all of New Mutants. Apparently, they cut it, like, John Hamm was the villain, and they replaced all of the villain scenes with a new villain.
Did you say John Hamm?
John Hamm was help me out here, Corey. The Mr. Sinister who's
Mr. Sinister is the villain for New Mutants. Fuck that.
I don't know, but he's I forget.
Although he'd be a really good Mr. Sinister.
I'm not as X-Men as you guys, so I might be wrong, but I think Expert. That was it. And also he was in Legion, which is technically in the same cinematic universe, so I was headcanon making it the same character, but it wasn't.
False Marvel.
All I know is that my wife is actually interested in seeing a New Mutants movie, and my wife is not into comic book movies or comic books at all, but because this is a horror themed movie, she's like into it, and I'm like, fucking shit, I ate at that fucking New Mutants bar every month. Like, I had the subscription when they used to extend it to your fucking house. I love the New Mutants. I loved the Uncanny X-Men at that point in time. Like, it was everything to me. So that my wife will go see this? Fuck yes.
I'm curious what's wrong, because the trailer came out like 2 years ago at this point, and it looked great. And I really wonder like what's keeping them from letting it go. Like,
I think a lot of it has to do with the Fox Marvel merger. The Fox Disney thing is whether or not Disney would actually let them do it. Because of course you don't want to just put out the New Mutants and have it be just the New Mutants. You want to have at least a trilogy of films. The worry is that Disney is going to say, well, fuck all the mutant stuff. We're going to just start over again. Yeah, so why even put this movie out and lose the money that they're going to have for distribution on it when they can just direct a video at like the Generation Next TV movie?
Then why not direct a video? Unless you're saying they're waiting to see if the deal actually goes through.
I think they're waiting to see. And maybe if they can take some of this and salvage it for a rebrand in the Marvel Universe.
I feel like they could make money on it just on the cast alone and the fact
The villain was replaced with Ham was replaced with Antonio Banderas.
I mean, I love Banderas.
Well, now fuck it.
Yeah,
but is it a different character? Did they completely
no? Rewrite? So here's the thing: the IMDb has no character listed for him. I found an article that has eight potential or seven potential, but it straight up says he will not be playing Mr. Sinister.
So it was literally went out of their way to be like, Jack's wrong.
Yeah, so I think Ham was playing Jack's Mr. Wrong. Sinister, and now they've rewritten it.
Okay.
To not be him, and every person that is listed I've never heard of.
And like, okay, so if we're talking about this Fox Disney thing and they're hesitant, blah blah blah, I still can't see how they could go, oh, we'll make more money if John Hamm's not in the movie. I'm very curious what the story behind there is. Dark Phoenix, actually, I think it's all done and it's a much bigger budget, so it has to come out. But Ben might be right, because Bryan Singer is persona non grata right now, so I don't know if they can release a film by a rumored pedophile.
Oof.
Well, he got credit for Bohemian Rhapsody, and that just won a Golden Globe.
And that's what raised, and the fact that it won is like now what's making everybody, like, now he's on everybody's radar. So we'll say, especially if it's Disney. Do you think there's a chance that the post credits of Avengers 4 will have Hugh Jackman in it?
Yes, I do.
I think that's the only way you can like top and end the original phase 1, 2, and 3 of MCU.
All this X-Men shit sucks. They need to scrap it all.
Yes.
No, but I could see them being cynical, especially with Hugh Jackman. Like, yes, would everybody be better off if he's not Wolverine in the new MCU? Yes, but I can't if he's down for it. And just what a fuck you, what a mind-blowing post-credit sequence that would be. I could see them just giving in and just doing it.
If it just turns out to be some dream sequence of Deadpool's, that would be even better.
I don't like the Deadpool movies. I can't.
I know, but it would, at least it would be something that would make sense.
Because you're right. Because Deadpool would also be Disney, right? Yeah. Okay. I like that. Yeah. I like that. I just hate the fact that Ryan Reynolds might actually end up in the MCU as Deadpool. Oh God, I just hate him so much.
Ben, do you dislike Deadpool as well?
I don't really care. I don't
just
think
I'm asking for a friend.
I don't think that Deadpool needs to be rated R by any means. I liked Deadpool when I was like 16, during the Joe Kelly and Ed McGuinness run.
Yeah.
And it was like laugh out loud funny. And so I like that.
And Spider-Ham, in the new Spider-Man movie, Spider-Ham has a similar kind of thing as Deadpool in terms of the breaking the fourth wall and knowing he's a cartoon. And like that's rated PG, if anything, right? I don't know if it's PG-13, but
I don't know if it's the fourth wall stuff. I think it's just like that he's so crass and he talks about masturbating and he talks about his schwants and all this stuff. I wish all Fox X-Men movies did not exist.
I don't see how you bring Jackman back as Wolverine at this point when he was done playing the character. He put the cap on the character. And because I don't know how far forward you can go with Jackman as Wolverine. Plus, he's always been a really bad example of what to be Wolverine in a movie. Not because he's bad, not because he's not a great actor, but because it's so not Wolverine.
Yeah.
No, the only reason I could see them doing it is A, he said, I'm done ever playing Wolverine again unless I can be in the Avengers. He literally said that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well.
B, I could see Disney going, yes, these are all great points, but Hugh Jackman as Wolverine will automatically be an extra $50 million or something like that. And I could see them doing it, even though I agree with everyone. He shouldn't be Wolverine.
Can you do just Hugh Jackman and none of the other bullshit fake movie X-Men?
Like, if I was in charge, I think the Fantastic Four is what's going to probably be the big.
Hell X-Men. Yeah.
Not. I don't think the X-Men will come in right away just because it really does overpopulate the universe with superpowers.
Yeah.
And they technically already have the Inhumans, but barely. But if I was in charge, I think the way I would do it is I would make Avengers 5 a multiverse film.
Yeah,
and that way you have the X-Men universe, basically like the DC verse Marvel comics. You have the Avengers universe, the MCU, and you have the X-Men, and they cross paths for this limited movie or trilogy or whatever. That way, it's an ensemble film. You don't have to push Hugh Jackman too much. You might kill him off like Solo in the first film, so he can get out of it. But you can say you've had him in the MCU, and I could see them doing it that way, and then doing a swan song to the Fox X-Men movies that way, where you keep them. They're interacting with Doctor Strange and Black Panther, but at an arm's distance. That's how I would do it. Who knows what the plans are going to be? I think the Fantastic Four will probably be a mainstream MCU movie.
I
think that the problem is that the timing just didn't quite work out where Disney gets the acquisition of the Fox properties in time to do the justice that they need to, with the fact that we have a reality altering storyline in Avengers 3 and Avengers 4. This is the moment when you then say, okay, so we can fix this and we can bring in the X-Men, we can bring in the Fantastic Four, we can do all this stuff and make a new universe that makes sense while including these other characters that haven't been a part of it, obviously, so we don't have to hide them in the 90s in some mystical story like they're doing with Captain Marvel, which, shit, I'm totally into Captain Marvel, don't get me wrong. But obviously we have to forego the reality that this couldn't have happened, but it did happen.
That's why I think a Jackman cameo could be possible. It could be somebody like, who knows undoing that snap, what ramifications it could have had on reality. Or maybe it's even more explicit, and they retcon out Downey Jr. and Captain America. Whatever they do, I could see them still having time with this deal to last minute. Although it is coming down to the clock, last minute have Hugh Jackman suddenly in New York City or whatever, and I could, and then they can go, look, all we need is that. They still have several years to then figure out how they're going to do it, because you don't have to really bring up the X-Men or anything in any of the next round of Marvel sequels. But I could see them putting in Hugh Jackman for exactly that reason, just to be like, look what the snap did.
Well, the other thing is, what happens when Marvel is now introducing a lot of these characters into shows for their streaming service? Do we lose the need to put them into giant blockbuster films, but give them 10 episodes here and there on Disney streams? And then Hugh Jackman doesn't have to spend years away from home getting jacked up, but he can do something that's a little bit more subdued as a Wolverine character and have some crossover potential with Captain America or whatever.
That's a good point. That depends on how well this Disney streaming does. I'll probably do fine. But what's that? Falcon and Bucky, and there's another one they're doing. And
Scarlet Witch and Vision are supposed to get a series together. I think Loki's getting a show.
Moon Knight.
I don't want to watch it. There should have been a Moon Knight Netflix show. That would have fit well in that universe, but that's all.
I would have.
It's still a question of what's going to happen. All that
Moon Knight is still one of the few. I feel like if I start a career as an actor, I feel like there's still room for me to get in the MCU somehow. And I think Moon Knight was.
Yeah, that would be a good role for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't the biggest thing with blockbuster films like getting people off their asses to go to a theater and spend the $10? And when you have a streaming service where you're already automatically going to have an audience kind of built in, don't you eliminate the biggest hurdle that you have of like, how many shitty things have we watched on Netflix because it was on Netflix And now it's like, well, I know Netflix has shitty movies, but I'll fucking watch Bright. I'll see what's up.
Yeah. I'm curious where this Disney thing is going to go. I'm sure a lot of people will get it, but Netflix will be fine. You know, Netflix will be fine. HBO did the same fucking thing. There was all original programming, and then, you know, now we just watch whatever cool movies they have on. And it actually came around full circle, I guess. But Netflix will be fine. I am curious if this Disney thing might blow up in their face, but we'll see.
Oh, very possibly. But they've got so much. They own so much content now, so many IPs.
That's the thing. And it's the problem with these big multinational corporations is they all run on stockholders, and stockholders just want, they don't care how much money they're making. They care about how much money they're making more than they were last year. Right. So you have to, it's the same problem with Apple. Apple has to keep coming out with these new shiny devices. It's not good enough that they have 90% of the market share with the iPhone 6. They have to keep, they've literally, everybody has an iPhone, you know, except for a certain amount of people, and they've pretty much peaked. But the stock goes down because their numbers didn't go up, even though it's still a ridiculous number.
But that's because we live in a world where it doesn't matter what you've done; it matters what you're continually doing.
Exactly, and that's what's where that's what Disney. So I think Disney streaming will be successful, even if it doesn't see, even if we all hate the streaming or we're not watching their shows for the next 10 years or so, the streaming is going to be successful because they are going, their numbers are going to gradually increase, and the stockholders, yeah, let's keep it going. Let's do it. Yeah, sure. Loki show, Vision show. Let's do a Rocket Raccoon show. Sure. As long as people keep doing Disney Plus, eventually Disney Plus will peak the same way Netflix has. Everybody has Netflix now. Everybody has Netflix.
or a shared password from Netflix.
Yeah, and their problem now is that nobody else can get Netflix. They literally can't get any new customers unless they crack down on this sharing password thing.
But we also live in a world where Disney is like Apple, is like Google, is like Amazon, where the numbers don't matter because they'll start changing the metrics. They'll start telling you what they're going to tell you the numbers are. And it doesn't matter. They don't have to tell you how much we sold of an item. All it matters is that the Alexa items were the best-selling product on Amazon on Black Friday, Cyber Monday, or whatever. Apple only has to say we were this profitable as opposed to how many iPhones we sold. We don't have to give you shit. We're telling you, and you better enjoy it because we are the most powerful company on the fucking planet.
And then they take over the country, and then it's Weyland-Yutani, and we're living in some kind of corporate dystopia. But we'll have a Bucky and Vision show.
Right.
It'll be great. Everybody loves Vision and Scarlet Witch. It'll be fun.
I fucking hate them.
They'll be like it'll be like moonlighting. Instead of Bruce Willis and Civil Shepherd, it'll be Viz and Scarlet Witch.
Oh God, and they hate each other and they like each other. The will they won't they? And will they have robot babies?
And eventually her Eastern your vaguely Eastern European accent, which has gradually gone down with each time we've seen her, eventually she will literally just be like from like Brooklyn, like Scarlet Witch will just say, like, yeah, I'm from Sokovia. What's it to you? Yeah.
But she gets to be a mutant again. Now's the opportunity for her to not just be some creation. She actually gets to be the daughter of Magneto.
Yeah, that would be great if you bring in Ian McKellen as Scarlet Witch's dad. That's fun.
Another thing.
You can have fun with this stuff. They don't have to be so goddamn calculated.
There's an artist, Chris Cross, who he did, he worked for Milestone back in the day. He's done stuff at Marvel. He did a really great series with Peter David of a different Captain Marvel, like the son of the original Captain Marvel. One of my favorite artists, he posted something the other day where someone was saying, how do they do the X-Men if they recast now? He said someone came up with the idea of making Denzel the new Magneto.
Ooh.
Because in this case, instead of him being someone who's had to go through the stuff in Germany, has gone through the African-American oppression here in the States and stuff. And that is another thing, is that we see of these characters have to change to be modern day, because you can't have a 90-year-old Magneto in a couple.
You're right. You can't have a Holocaust Magneto if it's taking place in the modern day. That's interesting. I like that. I'm no Dan Mulhall. I can't do impressions. Let me see if I can do this. Okay. All right. Okay. I'm trying to think of a Magneto line. Now I blew it. See, this is why I can't do impressions.
All you need to do is that they fucked a cow person to make mutant children, because isn't that what they changed his origin? It's like he had sex with some sort of like mutated cow that was also, I don't know. A lot of weird stuff with the High Evolutionary in comics.
High Evolutionary shit.
Yeah.
Keep this comics, keep the X-Men talk going. I have to use the little girl's room.
Yeah.
Do we have to?
You know, the one thing that the MCU has done that I really like is they've taken characters that I have not enjoyed in the comics, and they've made them palpable and compelling and just, like, easier for me to wrap my head around. And Vision and Scarlet Witch are one of them. I did not understand Black Panther as a comics reader, and then the movie made it very clear. They made the Guardians of the Galaxy very compelling. But, Corey, can you tell me, like, what Carol Danvers' deal is? Why should I care about Carol Danvers?
Well, if you're going off of the comics, and this is what I think the movies have done successfully and the comics haven't done, is they've been able to take 50 to 70 to 100 years of stories and distill them to the bare essence and to make something that makes sense. The comics are constantly trying to follow a continuity. They're trying to regulate stories that happened in 1942 to things that happened in 2017 and make them all work together. And where you've seen DC flip that switch over and over again and say, oh, we're going to start over and here's Superman and here's Batman and here's Wonder Woman. But for some reason, here's four incarnations of Robin. Here's 101 Green Lantern stories that have to make sense in some way, even though they shouldn't. Marvel is still trying to distill. Spider-Man took place in this time and made web shooters himself and made a costume himself, even though that makes no sense. And the Fantastic Four were part of the trying to go into space and stuff. And it's like, well, that shouldn't make sense if they're only 20 years old, although they have kids of various ages. Right. So how does this all work? The movies forewent all of that and said, well, we started them today, which is what the Ultimate Universe did. So if you are trying to figure out what Carol Danvers is, look to the Ultimate Universe versions of her. And as opposed to being the person who kind of like took over from Mar-Vell and got some of his powers, it's more of a, she's a badass pilot. She's someone who worked for the government. I think in this movie, it looks like she's actually lived on an alien planet her whole life. And instead of being the half alien on Earth, she's a half Earthling on an alien planet and how all that comes together. So what it's going to be when she shows up and interacts with a very early version of Nick Fury and an early version of Agent Coulson, I don't know. It's going to be a matter of how successfully Brie Larson does in the role. I think she's going to be great, not just from past experience of Marvel movies of them doing stuff that I like, but also because I dig her, and I think that this character is important for Marvel, but I'm not as worried about the origin because I'm not a giant fan. I had the first issue of Ms. Marvel back when it came out. I had the first issue of Spider-Woman when it came out, but these characters are obviously very different now. I knew Carol Danvers more as Binary, hopping around with the X-Men for years when Rogue had taken her memories and powers. And that's part that's inherent to the character that I don't think they're going to be able to approach in the films, just like they didn't really do a lot with Tony's drinking. Tony's drinking was replaced by Tony being
a party sick either.
From that disease that he had.
Oh, yeah.
But I just run with it. Just see if it's one that appeals to you.
The trailers do nothing for me. That doesn't mean anything. The movie might be amazing. The movie might be terrible. The trailers do literally nothing for me.
I think the Kree power stuff is cool, like the CGI when she's in space flying around.
She looks great. She does look great.
Looks good enough. You know, for me, she was always a footnote. She was always the character that Rogue stole powers from.
But that's, you know, also like
the generic Supergirl character
for Luke Cage and Jessica Jones. It's funny because we'll regulate a character for a number of years. I think she's also one of the numerous characters where it's like they got her pregnant one time and then had her have an adult kid because he time traveled or whatever and became romantically linked to him.
A rapist. Yeah, that's fucking weird, dude.
Fucking comics were weird. 80s were a weird fucking time. 90s were a weird fucking time.
Is that a Jim Shooter story?
I don't think so. I feel like that's someone else that came in that took over from Shooter stuff, but maybe it could
I'm
be.
I'm curious. Have you guys seen the new Spider-Man film?
Not yet.
Is it good?
Spider-Verse? Homecoming?
Spider-Verse. I'm sorry. It's the most fun I've had at a movie theater in a while. I think it's one of the best comic book movies ever.
Who plays Spider-Man?
Everybody.
I can't think of so Miles Morales. I can't think of the guys. Shameik Moore, maybe he was in the Get Down, the Netflix show by the Moulin Rouge guy, Romeo and Juliet guy, Baz Luhrmann. He was not, he's not super well known. Uncle Aaron was Mahershala Ali, and the two Peter Parkers were Chris Pine and Jake Johnson.
Wait, there's two Peter Parkers?
There's a lot going on. There's a lot going on in the film. Oh, and Liev Schreiber is incredible as Kingpin. He might actually be a better Kingpin than Vincent D'Onofrio. I mean, Vincent D'Onofrio is great, but and that they're two completely different interpretations of the character, but they're both really good.
Well, Michael Clark Duncan was a good Kingpin. It was not a great movie, but he was good. It was just it was a different interpretation.
We were roommates when I saw that movie, Jack.
Yeah, we were. It was 2003, 16 years ago, next month.
That was the first time I took LSD. I thought the movie was great.
Oh, wow. So then no wonder we got along. I was sober, and for years I thought that movie was amazing.
I thought that movie was great.
Daredevil is like one of my favorite comics, so my favorite heroes. So I fell in love with that movie, and it took me a long time to really come to terms with the fact that it's utter garbage.
But it's utter garbage in hindsight. In that moment, at the time that we were seeing it, was it?
Well, yeah, the only thing you could compare it to was Spider-Man and X-Men, which were both obviously better.
Oh, Blade.
But, yeah, and Blade.
There's an Elektra sequel that doesn't have Daredevil in it.
Which I haven't seen.
What a wasted opportunity.
And I think is Stick in that?
He might be.
Yeah, Stick is in the
Scott
sequel.
Glenn is so great. Stick, he's the best part of that show.
Oh, Scott Glenn in the new Stick?
Yeah, he's my favorite part.
Yeah, he's fantastic. Yeah, that you can't hear that popping. It's driving me nuts.
I just heard it, but
I don't get it. It's just literally when my laptop is on and it's relatively near my speaker system, and my speaker system is off. The power is off, so it's somehow still putting electrical signals into the cables that is making sound come out of the speakers.
The power is off.
So back to Split. We might as well just try for a second. Another thing I'm worried about in Glass is that they give us this thing at the end of Split where to get Kevin back into the charge of his body is we tell him his full name, which is very Mixaplic. or Captain Marvel, the Shazam version. And so I wonder if that's another thing that's going to be like a giant reveal in Glass of like, oh, but then all of a sudden Glass says his real name and takes his powers away or something.
But it doesn't work anymore, right? They figured out how to...
It worked, and then he succumbs to it again because we know that the kid can overpower Kevin and come back to the light.
Right.
Can you tell me what happens at the end of the movie?
So, the psychiatrist comes to and tries to break them out, and she writes down. But she writes down. Say
Wendell Crumb.
Yeah, say his name backwards three times, and he will go back into the fifth dimension. It's basically that, and she escapes the main character. So she sees the beast is eating one of them. I think the other one also died.
Eating her?
Yeah, he's eating.
He devours one, and by devours, I mean he eats a little bit. There was a Kids in the Hall skit where they've got the guy on trial because he ate everybody on the plane because the plane didn't leave the tarmac for 20 minutes. It's like you didn't even eat like all of one person. You ate a little bit of one person and a little of the next person.
So she's escaping, and he manages to start bending the bars because he's so strong, and he's about to catch her, and she says his name, and he does become Kevin again, who we haven't met yet. He's like the regular guy, and
he's like I got the shotgun.
Yeah. He tells her again. Why? So you keep asking us to tell you the ending, and then we tell you the ending.
And then he knows it.
The whole thing.
And she shoots him.
All right. What more do you want from us? And then credits? Do you want us to name read the credits?
I'm out.
David Dunn at the end of the movie?
I'm sorry?
Who meets up with David Dunn at the end of the movie?
Nobody. Of consequence. It's so tacked on.
Meanwhile, in a diner.
Yeah, it's exactly 100% what it is.
It's in a diner. What's going on?
Meanwhile, guess who's eating in a fucking diner?
So here's the bullshit. Here's the absolute bullshit line of like, they're watching TV and they go, yeah, this guy who held these girls captive and killed two of them, killed the doctor and everything, goes by this name, the Horde. And some rando says, oh, this reminds me of that story from 17 years ago because that guy had a name that he went by, even though it had nothing else similar. It's just because he went by Glass and this guy's, they're calling the Horde. It's like, nothing now let me mention this thing in random so that the guy sitting next to me can perk up and say, hey, bitch, that was me. Suck my dick.
Yeah, Mr. Glass, literally, like, if I heard about a muscular man who can climb walls and he eats two teenage girls, I'm not going to go, that reminds me of that crazy terrorist 15 years ago. What was this? Oh, Osama bin Laden. Yeah.
Right.
Two things go hand in hand. But I did, but whatever, it works.
What a piece of shit. Yeah. My favorite is how the kid says it in the beginning. He's like, they call me Mr. Glass because I break like a glass. Oh, good. That's nice.
Whatever. What? Your standards are too high, Ben. You live your life with too high of standards.
In the 70s, we had Ben Vereen singing Mr. Cellophane because you can see right through me and walk right by me. So I can see kids calling someone Mr. Glass because he breaks like glass. That was actually okay. And I think that kid was probably the best actor in that movie.
Really? Wow.
Yeah. I think that kid was great. I think that it didn't transfer well to Samuel Jackson taking it over. I get your issues with him, but I agree with Jack. I think it's more how it was written than him actually like playing the part.
The kid was a good actor. McAvoy, maybe my least favorite acting he did was as the Beast. Did anybody notice his Beast voice was basically Chris Farley's Matt Foley? he's like the broken. If you're broken, you're more evolved. Hold on just a second there, Bill Shakespeare. You know, he's basically just so drawn out, like Chicago accent. It was very.
Yeah.
I did enjoy his tryout for the Chippendales dancer, though. I thought that was inspired.
That was a very good scene. Yeah. I was the Patrick Swayze's last role. It was great.
But so much of the thing was like the doctor is telling us things about this beast. Oh, you're going to turn into this beast creature who can walk on walls. Is it just stuck to them and everything? It's like, how much fucking laying out do they give to tell us the powers and abilities of this creature that we weren't seeing? And it's like, I don't believe any of this thing. And then it's like, oh, here it fucking happens. Here he is walking on walls. And that's the part that I have a problem with, is that I look at Glass and I think they're going to lean more into that. And that stuff looked really shitty.
Yeah, maybe it got more of a budget this time around. I don't know if it's a Blumhouse or, I mean, I'm sure if you have, see this purposely, like the psychiatrist isn't a big name. It could have been anybody. It could have been an older actress. It could have been a Julianne Moore. This new one, basically, the role is
Sarah Paulson.
So I could see you having a name actor in that, but they really don't. Even James McAvoy is a get, but he's not a Bruce Willis at Sixth Sense get. And I think Blumhouse, a lot of the you know, movies don't have to be expensive, but
well, it's going to be Disney this time because Disney owns the rights to the characters for.
Yeah, and if you're paying the Bruce Willis and Samuel L. Jackson salaries, the budget's got to be up. So maybe the CGI budget will also be raised. Maybe.
I think the budget's also going to be up because of the fact that it was the most successful film of 2017 budget.
So maybe it won't look so bad. Maybe it'll actually look really cool.
But when I see the commercials, it doesn't look good.
How much money did Split make?
Matt?
What I saw...
Corey said $100 million.
Yeah, it was like $100 million to the $9 million it cost is what I remember reading.
What a great movie.
I was disappointed I didn't see more of the identity.
Oh, Jesus, Corey. It made $278.5 million.
But I mean, the $100 million is the profitability of it.
Step one, collect underpants. Step two.
Hold on. Let's get back to this problem. If it cost $9 million and the box office made $278.5 million.
Distribution, advertising, all this other stuff.
Right.
And I'm just going off of numbers that I read. They're definitely right. Can be argued in a lot of different ways. But yeah, no, you're right. I knew it made closer to the 270 mark, but what I had read was that the profitability was considered so high because it made $100 million in profitability versus the $9 million cost.
You know, you never really think about that stuff.
Well, I remember Gregor mentioning once on Else Nerds the accountability of how Lord of the Rings is considered a failure because they did this creative accounting in the background of like they charged all these other things to the bottom line of those film series. And so it's considered a failure, even though it made billions of dollars.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing how it works.
Fucking like, bean counters.
Just give me $1 million. Disney can give me $1 million right now, not to make a movie. I just like, just give me $1 million. They won't even like notice it's gone. It will affect Literally nothing. Nothing will be affected if they give me $1 million. I just want $1 million.
Jack, I'll give you $1 million if you'll take a post-dated check.
Okay. Hilarious. Thanks, Uncle Matt. Thank you.
It's more of a Simpsons reference than anything.
I'll take the post-dated check.
Simpsons reference. Wait. The post-date?
All right. Bart gets the checkbook.
I can take advantage of one of those cash for gold people, and like I can run that shit through real easy. So I'll take your post-dated check. Fuck yeah.
You're not gonna want to cash that until 2045.
Do you think his dad died at a train in the train crash from the beginning of Unbreakable?
That's exactly yes.
Oh, that's
what,
shit.
That is exactly what they imply. And the reason that the beast comes out on the train is because the train is what sets him off. That whole memory of that is what causes the beast to manifest.
Do you think then the glass will have the same ending as Captain America: Civil War?
Oh my God.
The board finds out Glass killed his parents and like he turns on Glass.
Oh shit. That
seems like a very likely thing to happen.
Yeah.
I want to see the end of Glass be that Glass finds a way to harness the powers of these other two guys and he becomes powerful himself. He steals the powers away. Because that's the only thing I can see is to have him be considered the winner of this, is to have this be this movie. We already know his history, know his background, so it can't be another fucking origin story. It has to be a summation of like him getting the advantage. And I understand that the advantage for him has been mental so far, but just having these two guys who have incredibly similar abilities, the bulletproofness, the strength and everything else like that, I've never seen done walk on walls, but fuck it, you know, just put a couple paint cans on his back. He probably can. They've got to do something to make Glass be the ultimate villain of this.
Yeah, he's got to
because otherwise brain. The Horde should be, or Paulson should be as a psychiatrist.
Who do you think of the three of them has the biggest dick?
McAvoy.
Samuel Jackson's character has the biggest dick, but it's in 19 pieces.
Oh God.
Okay, yeah. So I mean, it couldn't really take a pummeling; it's going to crack in half. The Beast probably's got a monster.
That's what I'm saying. He can change his brain chemistry. He can like make more blood go down.
Yeah, I'm going to try. I'm going to. When we're done here, I'm going to just think about. You know what? You got a 6-foot dick.
I'm sure there's a whole split penis subreddit.
Power positive thinking.
The genitals of the split universe, the 616 train universe, or whatever it's called.
East Track 711 or something weird. Yeah. It's because it's named after the train that crashes. So here's another thing, Jack. You were talking earlier about the manifestation of the Beast's abilities and powers. That's very much in the vein of the mutants from X-Men and New Mutants and everything. Because you get your mutation. A lot of people say puberty, and a lot of them do have a puberty, but it's from some sort of traumatic change that happens over time. So some people get it when they're kids, some people get it when they're older, but it's usually something that brings on that power that's already inherent in them. So the fact that he manifests his other personality, and that personality brings the powers with them, goes back to comics.
Yeah. So because it's funny, because I was like, when you guys told me you were doing this movie, it's like, yeah, that's a really bit of a stretch for Podcast of Terror. And I was like, well, no, Split is a horror movie. Yeah. And I don't really see it as a supervillain origin story or a superhero story. I see it as a horror film that happens to be part of, you know, it's going to be a supervillain. But I didn't see it as a supervillain movie. And that's interesting because you're basically, that argument would say Shyamalan knew this whole time that it was going to be like the anti-Unbreakable. It wasn't just a tacky add-on at the end. He really does see this as the same themes and same sequel, a sequel to Unbreakable. That's interesting.
No, he planned this movie when he was making, he planned aspects of this movie, the story and stuff, when he was making Unbreakable. There were scenes that were supposed to be of Kevin in Unbreakable.
Yeah, the Hood is going to be the villain at the end, right?
I don't know about that, but I know that there were things that he like waited and years later put together in this. I think the audience didn't know that that's what this was, but it's just that ending feels tacked on because there's no reason for it other than I want this to connect this universe. He doesn't do anything in the movie to make it feel like they're in the same universe. It's just in that last second of like, oh, I heard a name. That name reminds me of this other name for no reason at all. And here's David Dunn drinking his coffee. Like, yeah, I guess I'm just here to get a check.
On top of that, there are a couple of references where they say superpowers in Split, which I didn't remember the first time. I was like, that's interesting. Where like she's talking to a colleague and they're like, we're not going to let you do the symposium, the international symposium. She's like, why not? And he's like, your ideas are crazy. And she's like, I think you genuinely can get like superpowers. And like they have, oh, that's what he says. He goes, you act like they have powers or something. And it's right. just all, it was very, yeah, you're right. It's interesting to think of Split, not just as a horror film, but as a
like Unbreakable, which didn't tell you it was a superhero origin movie until you went and saw it.
Is that true? You said that in the introduction, and I was only 15, so I don't remember the marketing campaign. But like,
I don't remember much of a marketing campaign.
I thought I knew going in it was about a superhero, but I
didn't at all. But I don't remember seeing a lot of commercials for it either. It was kind of like a whim to go see it. I saw it with a couple of friends, but none of us knew until we came out and we were like, wow, that was pretty cool. But it at least leads you along the way of what it's doing. This leads you along the way of a serial killer movie. And then at the end, it's like, but we're doing this to introduce you to the supervillain. Like, if this had not done that, if it hadn't been the ultimate ending was a guy with powers is the last personality, I think it would have been a better film. It would have been a better story. It would have made more sense.
It's just a thriller, not a supernatural.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah. I don't know what I would like better. I guess I've seen those thriller movies, so I guess I'm glad this one's different.
Like the girl who's gone through so much trauma being the ultimate survivor of another traumatic event like this, that's an interesting story. There's a lot to that I could like in this. But it feels like I told you all that shit just to get you to point B so I could tell you point C.
Yeah.
No, that's a great point.
He's not a great storyteller. There's a lot of fat and bunk and bullshit.
He's got a great eye.
He's got a good eye, but there's like fake psychology and fake phenomenology. It's just weird.
He's also the Stan Lee of his own universe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he shows up in this film, he shows up in Unbreakable, he shows up in all of his other stuff. I wondered if it was the same character. I kind of wondered if it was like he's a drug dealer at the game. And then he goes on to kill the preacher's wife in Signs. And now he's like trying to make ends meet by working with a psychiatrist who he probably has had to get a bunch of therapy with himself.
and he lost his great job as a doctor because he lost his patient, a well-known psychiatrist. I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So guys, I gotta go soon. But I can't go without talking about 90 Day Fiancé.
I'm sorry, I was laughing too hard. What'd you say?
Can we take just a few minutes to talk about 90 Day Fiancé before I go?
Just listened to you fucking assholes talk about X-Men for 45 minutes. We can talk about 90 Day Fiancé.
I still don't know what it is. I don't know what it is.
It's great.
Shit went down this weekend. 90 Day Fiancé is lit.
Oh God, it's such a great fucking
Ben,
show.
I fell asleep in the last 20 minutes of 90 Day Fiancé.
Can you describe the last 10 days to us, please?
How did it happen? All right,
so the last thing that happened on the 90 Day Fiancé Instagram is that Larissa and Colt are divorced.
Yeah, Larissa and Colt are divorced. Yeah, we know.
Scratched up his face, and then there's all kinds of other...
Did you see why she freaked out?
Over porn, I think.
Yeah, she found that he had signed up to and purchased a porn video.
That's
Let me
it?
Tell you, if my wife hit me every time I did that, I would not have any teeth.
Also, who
or
buys
you would
porn
ejaculate video? A lot.
Who pays? Who pays for porn?
He's an idiot. He's so okay. Norman Bates, it's unbelievable. He literally quotes Norman Bates. Jack.
Yeah. Did you notice on when they were driving to the reunion show that he had the seatbelt go under his titty? He has such a sick set of man tits.
What Corey, do you know this show?
What's that?
Does Corey know this show?
What channel is it on?
I know that Matt's into it.
What did you say? It's on TBS?
TLC.
TLC. Oh. And it documents people trying to get a K-1 marriage visa. Mm-hmm. So it's people that are trying to get green cards, but some of them are scammers and some of them are in love. And they're all fucking crazy.
If they're scams and they're being videotaped, then how do they get visas?
Because a lot of times it's stupid people. So there's a dude from Wisconsin that's on it.
Like they're breaking the law that
way. Oh my God. Yeah. The one in Wisconsin.
Dude from Baraboo. Yeah.
So here's the thing. It'll all be worth it as long as Lita turns out to be the world's greatest doctor.
So they'll probably be like a 15 years later where we're checking in on them as naturalized citizens and stuff.
I hope so.
Well, a lot of their relationships fall apart.
Yeah, but the chick he's talking about is married. She got married to a dude in Wisconsin, and on the show was like, yeah, I just moved here for my medical career. And he was just like, it's okay. She likes me. And that's what most of them are. They're like, yeah, you're all right. And they're like, they love me.
For the show, but you can't be on the show. That would break the whole, it would ruin everything. It's so stupid.
I feel kind of torn because as ridiculous as it sounds, I just watched the anniversary special about the Bobbitts. And it's like, God, if we were not enwrapped in that when that shit was happening, I would have watched a TLC show of that 100%.
Yeah.
I 10 years ago, I watched every episode of John Kate plus 8 in like a week. I marathoned the whole thing. And I loved that. And I was like following them on social media. And I just thought it was such a cute story.
Now I know why you're miserable all the time.
This was before any of the scandals and everything. I was so heartbroken when John turned out to be cheating on Kate. And then when Kate became like kind of a stage, it was just a very sad story. But those first couple,
Kate's haircut is the haircut I was talking about earlier.
Really? That's hilarious.
I'm pretty sure that is 100% it.
Like half of an eight. We've come full circle.
Oh, fuck.
All right, Shyamalan's.
Ben, what are you going to rank this movie? Ben, what are you going to rank this movie? 1 to 5.
Both movies.
Both of them.
They're both pieces of shit. The Unbreakable, I hope to never watch it again.
You can go 0 to 5.
One.
Are you sure Unbreakable is getting a 0?
Okay.
I'll give it a 1.
I'll give it a 1.
All right.
What about Split?
Split. Out of 5? A 3.
Huh. Split down the middle.
I'm curious to what Glass is like, but I think these movies are pieces of shit.
I'll give you a hint. Half full.
Yeah. I like The Village. Might be my favorite one of his movies.
Yeah, it's
and I like Signs.
I love Signs.
But mostly what I was taken by when watching Unbreakable was how unpleasant it was. And it took me a while to realize that was like a symptom of it being a thriller. But it just moves from like one unpleasant, uncomfortable scenario.
Yeah, it's very sad. Everybody's just moping around.
No happy scenes in his movies. I'm not into that.
But it does end happy for his relationship with his wife. I mean, that's family true. Itself comes back together, and that I think is different because it's usually a little bit darker. Although I guess the kid gets happier with his mom at the end of Sixth Sense, but his family heals.
Yeah, but that's why Signs actually has humor throughout the whole film.
Yes,
it's one of the only ones.
Yeah,
Lady in the Water too. Lady in the Water's got quote unquote humor.
That was Paul Giamatti.
Yeah.
Oh man. Yeah, I don't know. The comic book stuff, I can't get past it. It looks like there's more of that in Glass.
Well, I'm certain.
He's like, he just pulls stuff out of his hat. He's like, I believe that comics were a form of history we've forgotten to tell. Like, what the fuck are you talking about, dude?
Well, you could also just take it from the standpoint that he's fucking retarded.
He's nuts. Yeah, he's out of his mind.
Here's my hope with Glass is that Sarah Paulson is going to be on the new series from the guy who does American Horror Story and stuff. I forget his name. Not a big fan of the shows and everything. I think a lot of Ryan Murphy's stuff. I think is more missed than hit for me, but she's going to be playing a young Nurse Ratched. So I hope in Glass she just sits there and puts a pillow over everybody's faces.
I liked her in Bird Box.
All right, guys. See you later.
All right, later, buddy.
See you later, man. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry I didn't finish these awful movies.
You didn't finish them.
That's okay. You didn't finish the awful podcast either. So
you watched the whole movie. You know
how long are you going to podcast for? We do it for 2 hours.
Still pretty short for Jack being on.
Man hasn't peed 9 times yet.
I gotta watch True Detective tonight.
Oh yeah.
That's right for tonight.
Boom.
True Detective.
So behind on TV.
Good day.
Go see Spider-Man. Take care, buddy. Ben, we're gonna go see Spider-Man. It's so good.
When do you want to do that? You think it's gonna be in theaters?
Let's schedule it now. Let's pick a theater. We'll get the tickets on the phone right now, live on the air.
Right now?
Yeah, that's fine.
Thanks, Matt.
Take care, man. I was good to see you again.
Later. So Matt, what would you give this movie? Since we're all ranking it, let's get the ranking out of the way.
And we're not done though, are we? Do you need to get going?
I have a little longer.
I expected this to be over 3 hours.
No, I don't. I told you when you asked me. Okay. I told you I'm very, very. This has been a long week.
If it stops, it stops. That's why I wanted to do this earlier
because I want to get the rankings out of the way
in case this went 4 hours.
That way I can hang out up until my last drop of energy and we don't have to worry about wrapping up the show.
Fair enough. I gave it a one, Unbreakable 1.5 and Split a 4.
Okay. Corey?
Actually, I'm almost exactly the opposite of that. I'm probably a 4 on Unbreakable and yeah, Split 1.5 sounds solid.
Okay. I will do a 3 for Split and a 3.5 for Unbreakable. And I think there's a 0.5 margin of error for either of those. Does that work? Can you put margin of error into your spreadsheet?
Yep, I am right now.
Here's a couple of notes left I had about the movie. I wanted to see more of the identities. It works. You can't really overload them. And it was cool when they all started coming out at the very end. But if you have 24 to work with, and I know you want to save some for the sequels, I would have been curious to see. And the ones we did see, they seemed a lot. I mean, I know we only spent like 30 seconds with them, but they seemed much less interesting. Like they seemed like they were
just tacked on. They didn't seem like they were pushed at all.
Yeah, I didn't like that. So one of the personalities, Jade, where Casey finds the videos on the computer, like one of the ones where you hear the audio is of her, I think. And then she comes out later.
Yeah.
So it's like, did they only do that?
What's that? Jade Norwell, I think, are the two we see in the videos are all the two we get.
The two that come out later. So it's like, did you only do that so that you knew already?
Yeah, probably. You're probably right.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have to treat the audience so dumb. I would have, anyway.
And it's like, and I know you've made this point on the Simpsons podcast when it still was happening, but it's like, sometimes a joke happens and then the answer is spoon fed and it's like you don't need to do that.
Yeah. We like a little challenge.
Well, people used to like a little challenge. Apparently, they don't anymore.
I don't know. You like Deadpool? You tell me.
Because I like dick and fart jokes, and I think Deadpool is just a fun dick and fart joke.
I can absolutely see Matt of all superhero movies, that's the one that he's going to lean towards. And that's what I like about Deadpool is because it adds to the sense of like everybody can pick one.
I like dick and fart jokes too. I love dick and fart jokes. I just think I like good dick and fart jokes. And I like Rick and Morty has good dick and fart jokes.
That's true.
Deadpool, I think, has very lazy where they're not even jokes. He's saying dick and fart, and that's the joke. He's saying be better. Be best.
I like Rick and Morty too, but sometimes I just really like an easy dick joke. Like just at face value, a dick joke.
Oh, I think I like my dicks harder. I'm sorry,
but sometimes I like a good hard dick too. Like I'm not like it depends on the mood.
I think Deadpool. I think.
But here's the other thing: when I go see Deadpool, I know what I'm getting. I know I'm getting straightforward dick. If I'm going to sit down and watch Rick and Morty, I want to think about my dick a little more.
I got to say, I like Deadpool more than I like Logan because I think Logan had a lot of things that were okay, but I think that its opinion of itself was much higher than what it deserved, where I think Deadpool knew exactly what it was going to be and went 100% into it.
If Logan wasn't Hugh Jackman as Wolverine, if you take out the fact that it's an X-Men movie, it would be a mediocre drama about like a road trip drama with the old man. You know, there's been 3,000 movies like Logan out in the last 30 years. And people just happen to have superpowers. That's why. And it was a sequel to very silly movies that weren't like it. But I think Logan's successful at being a X-Men film, but you're right. It's totally overrated. I still think it's better than Deadpool. Do you guys like Family Guy? See, like Family Guy, I can watch it. And I know I don't watch it, but when I watch it, there's usually 3, 4, 5, 6 jokes in a Family Guy where I go, that's fucking brilliant. And then there's like 90 jokes where I'm like, what are you not even trying?
Well, the problem is the Family Guy got rid of that 10 jokes a long few seasons ago.
The 10 brilliant ones?
It's so rare. We still watch it, but we both kind of look at it like, why are we still watching this?
Because it's easy to digest too. It's a very...
Yeah. And it's better than The Simpsons.
It's a watchable show. Yeah.
American Dad's better.
That's what I've heard. And I did watch a bunch of American Dad years ago. my girlfriend at the time was a big American Dad fan. So I would, she would put it on at like 2 a.m. She slept late. And so, yeah, I watched a lot of American Dad in that context. I never marathoned it. Yeah, it seemed pretty good.
Yeah, I think they put out the Cleveland Show just to try to make Family Guy look funny still.
I'll tell you what, like Family Guy, I started watching it again. It's not what it was.
Right.
But it's still once in a while. Like, I think of all the shows that have been around for 15 plus years, South Park is still the best.
South Park, I think, yeah, I don't know. I think the drop in quality for South Park is huge too. Maybe yes. Not as Simpsons and Family Guy,
but it was such a high.
And they're once in a while you get a great episode, and on the Simpsons, I've only seen that in the context of my podcast. We've only seen one legitimately good episode, and for me, I still don't think that episode is as good as the classic years.
No,
whereas South Park, every once in a while, I think it's gotten much worse in the last, like, say. Not much worse. It's still a good show, but like the line of it gradually going down while the other shows are going straight down. I feel like it's starting to get super. But the Amazon episode, yeah, I thought was very good. The season finale this year, the 2-part Amazon episode, I thought that was the best South Park in the last like 3 or 4 years.
South Park, I don't like it as much when they started incorporating like season long story arcs.
Oh, right. I like that. I don't mind that because it doesn't usually get in the way.
Well, and I'm not saying I dislike it, but I think that was kind of the point in which it started to downslope because
they stopped
relying so heavily on everything that's pop culture, and they started actually having a story. Now it's still funny, but like I couldn't tell you the last time I finished a new Simpsons episode.
Well, the thing about South Park is that it's usually very topical. That sense of like they start an episode that week and finish it that week and then make it to air just a couple of days later, that was what was always impressive about it. So you would just be watching it. And yeah, it would seem like some of the story was like there's A plot and B plot, and the B plot is the stuff that's topical, and the A plot is the stuff that's not, but they work seamlessly to make it all happen.
But now it's all, every episode's one of those now. Every episode is an issue episode, every single one. Whereas back in its prime, they had episodes that were evergreen. Like the my favorite episode is the season 8 premiere with the anime and the Japanese weapons.
My favorite part is the song. You
know, Scott Tinneman Must Die isn't topical. That could have came out any episode. And like I think of one of South Park's problems is they've felt like this is their identity, and maybe it is. If there's so many animated shows now, you have to like lean into your niche. But I miss the more well-rounded South Park. And I also don't like a lot of their fucking like anti-PC politics. I can't stand that shit.
But the thing with Family Guy to me, Jack, you might understand this, is you probably know about comedians who like to lean into the audience hating what they're doing. Like they'll do an act and you'll just see them bomb. Like I really cannot stand one of the guys on the current Saturday Night Live.
Pete Davidson?
Kyle Mooney. No, Kyle Mooney.
Kyle Mooney does not do a single thing
on that show that I like. And it's not about him as a person, but his characters are basically about, like, he does that comedian who comes out and does like the worst jokes ever and he just bombs and it's supposed to be funny, but it's never funny. But that's like his entire career in that show to me is just him not being funny. But some people, like a lot of comedians really seem to like when a bit just doesn't go anywhere, where the audience hates it. And it's kind of like the same thing of the internet of trolls, of like we're just trolling the audience. And Family Guy trolls the audience a lot.
I don't like that.
They want, here's a 20-minute musical act because we know people will complain about it on the internet tomorrow. Here's a just like leaning into as far into physically abusing a woman character because we know it's not funny, but let's just make as harsh a statement as possible. And just like, they do things to piss people off. They killed Brian off on the series for a while.
Yeah, I remember that.
The dog. And they put on the most annoying character. And it was to make the most annoying character exist so that you'll want Brian back. But it's not like Brian's not still terrible. But it was like they tried to – they made things specifically not funny with that character for a long time.
I don't like that. I have very – Seth MacFarlane is very interesting to me. I'm very – happy for his success because it's ridiculous, like how young and
super talented guy
and consistent, and he's just crazy talented, and he has an incredible work ethic, and I think that's missing with a lot of people. If somebody has a work ethic of like him or a Seacrest, I go, okay, you know what, you deserve some millions of dollars. And it's funny, most of his things for me are very hit and miss. Family Guy, I said there's jokes in one episode that I love and that I hate. His movies, I think the same thing, can have very funny. Overall aren't great. And then I'm watching the Orville now because I'm a big Star Trek fan, and it's fun. I think it's a failure of a show. I don't think it's very good, and I keep watching it because it is very good at what Star Trek Next Generation was good at, just being disposable, kind of watchable, you know, interesting. And I like what it's doing too. I like that most people, critics seem to hate that it's basically next gen. It's like not even trying to be different. I don't mind that at all. I like that, and I like the working class, like, kind of jokes of like they talk like regular people talk, but they're doing it. So like in one of the last episodes, they go, now, sir, now they're firing 20 photons at us. And Seth MacFarlane in the middle of the action scene goes, neat. And like, that's funny to me. What I don't like is, again, lazy fart and dick jokes. When they do a fart and, like, it's funny because it's a dick joke, but it's in space. That I don't like. So,
right. It's a dick in space.
Yeah, so it's amazing to me how, like, no matter, like, what you just described for me is exactly what I've been going through with Orville. And I guess it's just MacFarlane. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think MacFarlane's very funny, and I think that early Family Guy was more his baby than it is now, and I think that it's tanked because he's spread himself thin. He's done a lot of other stuff. And I believe that if it wasn't for the fact that it was such an institution for Fox, that he probably would have ended it years ago and moved on to something else. And he's moved on, but the show's still going, and all he has to do is show up and do voices. Yeah. All the voices, but whatever. But I watched the first couple episodes of the Orville, and I just couldn't get into it because I found the humor was not good humor. If it was an actual funny show, I would enjoy it. I have no problem with the next gen comparisons because I'm not watching Discovery. I'm not into that at all. But I would
I agree.
That show.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. And it's a shame because sometimes the jokes are good. There's an episode that's really well done where they're watching Seinfeld on the big screen in the bridge. That's very funny. Why wouldn't you watch a sitcom? Why wouldn't you use the bridge screen as Netflix? That's great.
Is that any more or less ridiculous than listening to the Beastie Boys in the third Star Trek movie?
Yeah. So like that's it, but they need more jokes like that. A lot of the jokes are, again, it's just dick jokes in space. It's like it adds nothing.
I would rather it be really funny or really sci-fi. It's just not enough of either for
me. It's actually very mediocre drama. And that's the other thing. If you're going to just be a drama and not even be funny and literally just be a dramatic next gen ripoff, the drama is so lazy. It's so just people telling their feelings. It's just, I don't know. It's very bad writing. If it wasn't a sci-fi, like Star Trek Next Generation, the characters are always doing things that you would go, oh, in that situation, that's what I would do. Or maybe that's not what I would do. Is like, I get why he did that. Bad writing is when somebody does something for the story and you literally go, why would they do that? You know, if you see yourself going, why would they do that to something you're watching? That's because it's bad writing. And the next gen was very good at not having that. You know, the special effects could be lame. The story could be lame. It could be a crusher episode, but every character is actually very unique to itself. And every character does what you would think they would do in that situation. Orville is literally just like, now we're going to go down to the and fight the monsters with no weapons. Shouldn't we bring a weapon? Ah, we're good. It's like, and then they have a scene where they don't have weapons. And then how do they get out of this one? And it's very just, you know, they'd bring weapons.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
No, you're not preaching to the uninitiated here. That's how I feel about it. And there are people I know who are really into it. I think Brad, who runs this network and everything, really likes Orville. And I don't take any issue with it. I like Matt, I'm also not the biggest sci-fi person in the world. So really easy for me to say that show's not for me.
Nobody's perfect.
I'm really into boobs. So sci-fi is kind of...
Well, then you should watch The Orville because there's some really attractive people on that show.
Well, watch Total Recall if you like boobs.
Not the remake.
the one that he has three of them. When I was in eighth grade, I was dating a girl with giant cans, and I told her that was my favorite part of the movie, and I think she broke up with me.
I love that that's supposed to be sexy, and like in the movie it works, you know. It's weird, and it's weird, it's Total Recall, but can you imagine, like, you meet a girl, you met her on
Bumble,
yeah, and you bring her home and you're making out, you had a couple of drinks, and you pull over her sweater and she just has three breasts. I would probably be like,
it fulfills the Douglas Adams thing for me. That's all it was. It was like the triple-breasted prostitute of Eroticon 6 from The Hitchhiker's Guide. That's, I was like, okay, now I've seen a triple-breasted prostitute in a movie. Great. You know, bucket list. Nothing sexy about it.
My goodness. I didn't like this in Split. I only have two last notes. I didn't like that the psychiatrist was like, the whole time she wouldn't believe that he's, you know, like what you were saying before about it, why she wouldn't believe there's a 24th personality, but she also wouldn't believe, she was so skeptical. She's like, one that can climb walls, that's ridiculous. But her whole like career seems to be around proving that this could happen. And like, she's talking about body chemistry and stuff. And every time she's talking to somebody in this movie besides James McAvoy, she's like defending the idea that these can give you superpowers. And then as soon as the breeze comes up, she's like, no, that's impossible.
Well, also her whole shtick of like, fuck, I realize that I'm being manipulated by this guy. I can call him out on the fact that I know that he's doing something wrong and the personalities that are coming to the head are dangerous and have dangerous thoughts and are trying to bring out something more dangerous. So I'm just going to randomly show up at this fucking zoo in the middle of the night and walk in by myself and hope he doesn't murder me.
It was very, yeah. Again, if you're asking yourself, why would the character do that? It's not great writing.
Yeah. And it's like, hey, I'm actually going to get to leave here, but instead, let me use your restroom so I can investigate further in a way that I don't know the police could.
Yeah. I mean, come on. Or at least go during the day with somebody, for Christ's sake.
Also, why is the whole thing taking place in a zoo? And where the fuck are the other people who work in all of those lockers that are just an earshot away from girls who are screaming and getting murdered? Why is he the only one who has access to this section until the next day when a guy shuts up and says, you don't belong here? Fuck, nobody belongs here.
And does he live there? Is that Kevin's job? Right. Or is that a job they got after they had permanently taken over from Kevin?
Also, at what point in a conversation on a walkie-talkie do you decide that you're just not going to believe anything a young girl is saying to you about being kidnapped and just hang up?
You can't hang up a walkie, though.
And that's a guy that they come out later on when the dude is walking her out of the place. He sees her, he looks up, he goes, oh, shit, yeah, he makes, I'm going to get fired.
Yeah. Oh my God.
I know a white person killed these girls, but I'm going to get blamed because brother, you didn't do anything.
I don't know. I would hate if I ever got a call like that. Like, help, I'm being, cause you would have to really convince me it wasn't like a prank or something. And then I would be like, oh, should I call 911?
But I always call 911.
But then I got to put my pants.
I will take the stitches for snitches because I don't give a shit. I'm calling the police.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it's a New York thing. Because if I had to take that hard philosophy, I'd probably have to call the cops every 5 minutes. There's always somebody screaming or running away outside.
Well, Jack, what you really should do is call 0118-999-881-999-119-725.
This joke's over my head.
That was from the IT crowd.
I have it if you want to watch it. I really think you would like it.
I know. It's on the list. Everybody tells me to watch it.
I can get it.
Oh, God. I just watched it like last year. I finally sat and went through the whole series, but I think that's from the first episode.
It's in the first series, at least.
There's like 50 shows I really have to watch. That's top 10. There's like 10 I really have to watch, and I just haven't had time.
Oh, shit.
Watch Orville. I can only watch these terrible shows that are on my DVR because I can't commit to like an actual marathon of another show anymore.
I'm like halfway through the fourth season of Bosch.
That's Titus Welliver?
Yeah.
I love him. He's a great actor.
That is a good damn show. But the episode I just watched was really rough. And for me to not go on to the next four episodes to come up and do this was hard for me.
Oh man, I get it. Because I watched Split and Unbreakable this weekend, so that was my TV time for the weekend. I didn't get to catch up on. I caught a little up on Voyager. That's what I'm doing, but I don't know. There's a couple of shows. I might do Marvelous Miss Maisel. Oh no, I want to do Killing Eve. That's the show I told myself I would do.
Oh yeah,
And now True Detective. I got to do True Detective.
Yeah, now that True Detective is starting again, I have to see if I can wipe the taste of the second season out of my mouth.
I hate when
I never finished it. I banned the second season.
I don't want any new shows to come out. Give me like a year to catch up.
Corporate starting again soon too.
I thought The Punisher was back today, and I turned it on, and it's like it is available next Friday or something like that, and I was relieved. I was like, oh, thank God, I don't have to sit through 12 episodes of The Punisher yet. But I'm gonna watch them. That's my OCD, I guess.
I didn't make it through the second season of Iron Fist, but I don't know how I made it through the first season of Iron Fist.
I like Iron Fist.
Daredevil season 3 was so good that it's just like shit. Now I feel bad.
Yeah. No, but I don't think The Punisher is supposed to be very good. I don't know.
I like the first season of The Punisher. I enjoyed it. I didn't have the problems with it. I think some Punisher purists did, but I was never a Punisher fan.
Yeah, even Iron Fist, which was probably the most flawed one. I don't think any of them are bad. None of them are good. Like great. Even like Daredevil at its peak, they're always like four episodes too long.
I think in a lot of the first season of Luke Cage did it, where they like changed the villain halfway through.
Broke it up into two seasons, basically.
And it feels so like, hey, we had something really good going, but now we're gonna fuck this up. Second season of Luke Cage was a little bit of a struggle for me. I think there was some good stuff there, but it was not as watchable as the first season was. Iron Fist just never seemed to improve from the first season on. I watched it for Colleen Wing.
She's great, yeah.
Yeah, I would have much rather it was a Daughters of the Dragon show as opposed to Iron Fist or Luke, really.
I could see Disney doing that. I could see, because if Disney brings them back to their streaming service, but with more toothless and less bloody, I could see them doing a PG-13 Daughters of the Dragon show.
Where they G.I. Joe it and like everybody's shooting lasers at each other, nobody gets hit. Oh, that ship just blew up, but there's a parachute coming out.
But they do that. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., the first Disney Marvel show. Nobody uses guns. They use icers. They tranquilize you.
Until it switches up partway through that first season, and then you just see blood dripping down somebody's hands. You're like, oh, shit, got real.
The Disney lawyers weren't looking that day.
Yeah.
Excuse me. I'll be right back.
Yeah.
Talk amongst yourselves.
God, I was just going to think. I'm like, should I pee? Should I make a tink-tink break? Or and now Jack's taking a piss or break.
And come back, dude.
No, nope. Because I don't want to leave you here by yourself on YouTube because it is very uncomfortable. It's happened to me.
That's okay. I mean, it's happened to me too. I just Garth it from Wayne's World into the screen.
All right. You're Garthing it.
I don't like this. I don't know Steven Strait, but apparently he's friends with Brandon. So hello, Steven. Welcome to the chat. Thank you for coming by. I saw Beatmaster tell me to fuck off earlier or to shut up Meg. That's all well and good. I don't know. I've only caught a little bit of the chat here and there because it's hard to like talk so much on the show and then see what you guys are doing. I don't know. The Disney thing, it's like I don't believe that the Netflix shows are going to come over to Disney. I don't think they're going to keep those actors. I don't think they're going to keep those storylines. I think they're going to start all over because don't the shows stay with Netflix? Don't they retain them? So it's like, we're not going to have you continue your story over here when you have to find the first few episodes somewhere else. It's the same thing as what they've had to do with Fox and Star Wars. If they don't get those back and they can't publish them themselves. So I'm kind of really iffy on it. And it's too bad because I think that those shows, for all the faults that I see in them here and there, I think they're good.
Have you ever pushed your pee stream so hard that you've gotten lightheaded?
Oh yeah, I'm lightheaded all the time anyways.
I just did that. I was like, I'm trying to piss so quickly, I'm gonna pass out.
You gotta understand, my dick is the most powerful portion of my body, so when it's doing something, the rest of me just kind of has to slag and fall over.
Wow.
I just have a hole in the middle of the bathroom floor. That's what I hope that it's going to land in.
Well, you should work on your aim.
It's not aim. It's like I blacked out. And so I have one of those public restrooms at a gas station kind of things. It's just like,
ooh.
Hope it all goes downhill.
I missed that, huh?
You didn't miss it. You just weren't here for it.
Oh, I like that. That's almost like a Hallmark card.
It'll get you on the way back out.
You didn't, I'll tell that the next time. I poor Ben. I didn't go to his wedding, and I really wanted to go, and I couldn't go. I had to drop out. And
weddings are terrible.
There's a lot of reasons, but
I don't like reasons. I didn't even like going to my own wedding. So
yeah, no, I wanted to go. I was dying to go. Circumstances kept me, but I should have sent that card. I didn't miss it. I just wasn't there.
I just wasn't there. That has to exist somewhere. Now I'm gonna look for it.
I like my wedding.
So yeah, tell me about your wedding, guys. Your weddings. I would like to think if I had more money to travel and I had known you guys then, I would have came. I would have been a table nine.
Well, Corey, when did you get married? I think we should do this in chronological order.
About 5 years ago.
Okay, so I guess I won because we're 7 and a half or something.
Okay, all right. So before we move on, so you've been married 7 and a half years. How long have you been in a relationship with your wife, Matt?
Just over 10 years.
10. And Corey, how long have you been in a relationship with your
wife? 19.
Yeah.
See, so he kind of wins. He just
has you want him to go first? Then
no, I wasn't sure to say anything about going first. I'm just relationship was my last 5 years.
Yeah. So I guess if we're going with that, this is the first time. This is the longest relationship I've ever been in by far. The only other long term girlfriend I had was like 1 year. And
her dad would
tell me every time she was single, even when Alyssa and I were engaged and living together.
Yeah, I've only had two girlfriends as an adult, and one long term one, like for a year, 2 years, whatever, in high school, and then maybe two or three, like two month long, you know, when I was a teenager.
Yeah,
but I've only had two relationships as an adult, and one was like 2.5 years, and one was like 5, but. Yeah, I don't know how my wedding would go, but I want to know what was your wedding? Was it like a big family wedding? Was it?
What do you want to know? Like,
what was your wedding song? That would set the mood for me.
The first song we danced to?
Don't you get like a wedding song? I don't know. I don't even know what finger the ring goes on. It's your wedding song is the song that you dance to, I think.
Yeah, so our first dance as a married couple was Little Hell by City and Color.
Okay, and Corey, what was yours?
We didn't have one. We didn't have any music. I actually, that's not quite true. My friend's stepfather.
The Gregorian chant.
My friend's stepfather, who's a very talented musician, showed up with a guitar and amp and everything.
Oh, that's awesome.
But we didn't plan on having any music. So my wedding was kind of like Charlie Brown's Christmas Tree, where it was supposed to be very simple, very, you know, basic, and people showed up and kind of brought more to it.
Okay. Okay. That's cool. Yeah, I don't know what when I thought I was going to marry my last girlfriend, it looked like it was going to be just a city hall and go to a nice place to eat kind of thing. It depends on who I meet. I could see myself. I don't know. I like smaller weddings. I think they're more intimate. I think there's something to it.
Ours was not
small.
No, my mom invited all of her friends.
So it was like a whole catering hall. You got a whole catering hall and everything. Oh,
it was at a hotel in Oshkosh, right off the highway. So the ceremony was at a place called the Payne Art Mansion in Oshkosh.
Payne, right there in the name, huh?
PAINE.
Oh, okay.
It's actually it's a super fucking cool place, but we could only have like 80 people invited to the ceremony itself.
Okay.
So we had to do like staggered invitations. So it was like, who did we want at the ceremony? And then who did we want at dinner? And then who did we only want to invite to the reception? So that was a fucking nightmare.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But that was really cool. It was in November, and oddly enough, it was like 60 degrees in November in Wisconsin, which doesn't happen. So
I was shining on you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So like we have pictures outside and stuff, and it was really cool. I don't remember much of the ceremony.
You drunk?
No. So you like customary to get your spouse a gift. And, in high school, one of my best friend died in a car accident. And, it was three of us. It was me, my friend Billy, my friend Nate. Nate is the one that passed away. Billy and I still talk to this day. I was best man in his wedding, and I wish he was best man in mine, but I have a brother. So
yeah. No, it's always good to go with the brother. I like that I have a brother. It'll keep a couple of my close friends from getting offended.
So when my brother was married, I was not his best man.
Oh.
And he got married after me, but that's a different story. So Alyssa got me cufflinks with Nate's pictures in them.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. So I wore those, and it was before the ceremony, so I naturally started crying, you know, emotional.
Yep, emotions are high that day.
Yeah. And one of the guys that stood up is my longtime friend James from Kansas, who owns this glassware company, who has the Shitter Was Full cup. And I had got him a really nice bottle of scotch. He likes scotch. So that was his groomsman's gift, was this bottle of scotch and a flask. So when I start fucking tearing up, he just hands me the flask. So I drank some scotch. So I was not drunk, but it was right. There are only bits and pieces of that portion of the day that I remember.
Plus you're running on so much adrenaline that you're...
Yeah. I barely slept the night before. You know, I was staying in a hotel, and I didn't even get to sleep in my own hotel room. I slept in someone else's because I just couldn't sleep. We had a nacho cheese fountain. That was like one of the few things that I really wanted. I'm like, this will be really cool. Instead of chocolate, let's do nacho cheese. And by the time I got to it, because every time you go, like you walk 5 feet, someone stops you.
Yeah.
So it's like I get to the nacho cheese fountain, and I'm fucking hungry, and it's gone. Everyone ate it.
Oh no.
Yeah. So the only other thing, my wife really likes Spotted Cow, which is a local to Wisconsin beer. My dad's like, I will buy you guys a quarter barrel. Well, they put the fucking tapper out, so by the time we got to the bar, that was gone.
Oh,
I was like, oh god damn it. So yes,
yeah, so, you kinda had to expect this.
It was just the only other thing I remember is someone who was not invited showed up and started drinking beer, and we had to be like, hey, that guy has, like, he can stay, but he doesn't get free beer. And then he left. Fast forward, all of a sudden it's midnight. I'm like, holy shit, we made it to the end of the night. And one of the few bands that I wanted to have played by the DJ, he didn't play them until everyone was leaving, which I thought was kind of strange, but
yeah, it's weird. Backwards.
Yeah. I mean, it is what it is. So we're fast forward to our room, because it's our wedding night.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't want to
go down. And Alyssa's like, do we have to? And I'm like, fuck yes, we have to. So I let her eat some cheese.
I don't think most couples bang on their wedding. I think they pass out.
I don't think so either. We had discussed, like, I mean, I guess all this full disclosure here is, like, we were saying, like, hey, we're not going to have sex for 3 months leading up to our wedding, and we'll have sex on our wedding night, and that'll be like, yeah, you know. So that's why I was like, this is happening. I'm like, I don't care if you're awake or not. This is happening.
No.
And it was very short. And it's just.
Why would you want to start off the marriage on that note? This is it. Here's what you get. Here's my 45 seconds of effort.
No, because that way she can tell her friends every time, last night was better than my wedding night.
Yeah. You set the bar real low. You can always.
Where'd you go on your honeymoon?
Honestly,
I just want a short answer. Yeah.
We were gonna go to there's a place. It's like 2 hours north of the cities, and it's called the Viking Inn, and it's like an all inclusive hotel, but it's like you live like a fucking Viking. So it's like
everyone, stone, and there's like bear rugs and.
Yep.
And like
you drink out of a big stone mug, and everyone, you know, it's just family style. And leading up to it, Alyssa was just like, you know what, I just don't want to go. And you know, November driving to the, you know, northern Minnesota, it's always a crapshoot.
Whose idea was it to do the honeymoon at the Viking Suite?
It was mutual.
Okay.
Yeah. So
we weren't forcing it on her.
No. Yeah, it was something we saw on TV, and we're like, that'd be really cool. So we changed our minds, decided to just go to Minneapolis. Because we have friends out there. Our friend's band, Johnny Rook, was playing. And Johnny Rook is like an acoustic band mixed with like crack. So it's like they're a straight acoustic rock band, but
like
they're
super fast, like
really high energy parts. Like there's actual screaming in it. I met them when I was in my last band, Sky and the Execution. We would play with them in Minneapolis. They would come. I still stay at one of the dude's houses, so I still talk to him. So that was like what we did, and they ended up breaking up shortly thereafter. So it was like really cool.
Way to Yoko Ono it, Matt.
I showed up and everything fell apart. Yeah, so it would, you know, we just decided to go hang out with our friends instead, and it was
that
like
that sounds great though. That sounds like a great time. Corey, yeah, did you go on a
honeymoon? Like, I don't know if we necessarily would have had a good time if we went to the Viking Inn.
Yeah, you know what I mean, what do you do after the sex? It's, you know, it's,
yeah. Everyone heard the walls are shaking. There's cum dripping off the walls.
Oh gosh, just like real Vikings.
Yeah, I'm a messy fucker. but yeah, so we just decided to hang out with our friends, and
that's awesome.
Yeah, I took her to Universal Studios a couple years later.
Very cool. Very cool.
Not for me, not her. She hates The Simpsons.
Corey, what did you do for your honeymoon?
Everything about my wedding was the opposite of that. So I was unemployed.
So instead of Vikings, what, you went to ancient Japanese ninja?
We went to the other section of Westworld. So I was unemployed for about a little over a year. Before our wedding, and it was a matter of, like, we'd been planning our wedding, and then I got laid off from Best Buy, and we kind of were like, should we just go ahead and do it, because we've been waiting this long. We bought the house instead of getting married, and the house turned out to be a big mistake, but let's just go ahead and get married. And we talked about eloping, but we had went to our friend's wedding, and it was my friend or Aaron's friend Rebecca and Rob. They got married at Rebecca's parents' farm in their, what was essentially their front yard. And it was so sweet, and we talked about it, and we had looked at different places to get married locally and everything. And I'm like, God, we just really loved Rebecca's parents' place so much. And we talked to Rebecca, and Rebecca talked to her parents. Her parents are the greatest people in the world. And they said, sure, host your wedding. Yeah, so we went up there. We rented a tent for outdoors. We actually got married in the backyard, so it was at least different. Invited my mom. My mom said, you have to invite your Aunt Holly Ray, or she'll be really pissed at you. You don't piss off Aunt Holly Ray. So my mom, my stepfather, my aunt, my Uncle Charles, who was the uncle that I modeled myself after as a teenager, was a guy with long hair and bands and stuff. My favorite person, who has been performing weddings for a number of years. He's an ordained minister. He came out to perform the ceremony. It was kind of like, I want to ask Uncle Charles. I don't expect to make the trip to California from Michigan, but he did. My Uncle Kenny came, and then all our friends that were local. It was about a 3-hour drive to where we were in Red Bluff from where we lived in Sonoma County. All my friends came up. We all basically stayed at the same hotel for the weekend. And I showed up at the wedding. Now, Aaron had terrific cramps that day. So she gets on some pills that my Aunt Holly Ray gives her, and she's blitzed for most of the day on this medication between that and the pain. And I show up, and immediately my uncle comes up and sees me. He goes, all right, so I need to talk with you about, you know, where the musician's going to play. And I'm like, what musician? And where's this? And I walk in, and it's like everything happened when I wasn't there. I like tried to do some pre-setup the night before. But I show up, and it's all very different, and everybody's there, and it's all set up, and it's just beautiful.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, we had gotten a caterer to bring food. We had tiered cupcakes, so it looked like a wedding cake, but it was cupcakes going up. And the topper was a giant cupcake. So the wedding happens. It's wonderful. It's everything I want. It's not all of the production. It's just really simple. It's our friends. We hang out afterwards. If I had had to pick a best man, it would have been my best friend, Anne, who was there for it. Erin kind of had her friend Mike stand with her, but not exactly. We didn't choose anybody, but that it was always kind of implied. My friends had thrown me a impromptu bachelor party the Friday before at our usual D&D game. And then one of my best friends, Michelle, made a Batgirl cake with breasts on and everything, and then shoved part of it into her chest, and then shoved my face into her chest. So it was really awesome, because I told her that she was one of my best friends, and she just was so impressed with that that's how that happened. And then the night after, I went to San Francisco to see a taping of the horror movie show that records down there locally. And they have a live band, and they have the cave girls and stuff. So it was a lot of BDSM style women and then the two hosts and everything. And I didn't talk to anybody like almost the entire time. I talked to the guy who plays the fact rat a little bit just when I first got there, but nobody knew that this was what I had chosen to be my bachelor party for myself. But we got up to Red Bluff. We did the wedding. And then we had gone to the same restaurant in town for like every meal while we were there for the couple of days before the wedding. And then we went there by ourselves after that. We had had food and stuff, but we were just so tired and so exhausted. Just went to this restaurant. It was just me and Aaron. And she got a, I think she got a porterhouse or something like that. Mm-hmm. And I got a burger. And we were just so relaxed after that. It was like, it was just, we were so done with our day. And then we went back to the hotel. We did not have sex, but she ate the entire cake topper herself. butchered the hell out of it.
That's and how then, it should be, though. That's like, that's bliss. Why stress yourself out with, you know, like bungee jumping out of a whatever, you know, all these crazy weddings.
Yeah, we didn't have a honeymoon, though, because we couldn't afford it. We could barely afford the wedding, although we wound up making money on the wedding with what everybody gave us.
Yeah, yeah.
And we stayed that night in the hotel. I think we stayed one more night after that. Everybody else had left, and then we went home. And my parents, who had driven out to California, came and visited us for a little bit during a few days. And then it was just like trying to find work after that. But our wedding was, we considered it perfect because it was exactly what we wanted, because it had nothing to do with what anybody else wanted. As much as like we wanted it to be approachable, we wanted it to be fun and just intimate. And it was like probably 30 people tops. And the invitations, I had written up the save the dates myself and everything. So they're really cute. And they've got our pictures on us. We did, took some pictures at our kitchen table and put them up there like a calendar thing. But it looks like when you go to get your pictures taken at the boardwalk and you have like those four shots, that's how we did it.
Oh, that's cute.
And then a couple years later, two of our best friends who went to our wedding had decided that that's what they wanted to model their wedding after. Now they did it more local and it was bigger. They had a lot more people, and they had the husband, Scott, his nephew DJ'd it. So they had actual music and dancing and things, and it was a lot of fun, but it was just really sweet that they liked our wedding so much. And then they had Aaron and I perform the ceremony.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
So, yeah. So that made us feel even more like we did the right thing.
And what's the phrase? Plagiarism is the sincerest form of flattery. Something like that.
Yeah.
See? That's all good. Did you guys know this? Did you guys know your own wedding stories?
No, I don't think we've ever talked about it. I think Matt secretly doesn't actually have a wife, because you never see her.
Yeah, just once in a while, I just played angry yelling in the background at dogs.
I think it's just a real doll that he just like pulls out every once and dances in front of the, like Kevin in Home Alone.
Well, if I ever get married, which is probably never going to happen, but if I ever find somebody who can tolerate me, you guys should come and
I'll be there
live from my wedding.
I'll be there.
Marriage of terror.
Heartbeat. Do we get to talk about the parts that didn't go the way that we wanted them to?
Can we save that for another episode? Because I am beat. I am.
Yeah, no. That's right. Fine.
But Jack, you still have to rate the movies.
I did. 3.5
or 3.5
with a 0.5 margin of error.
That's right.
So it might be so. I might go down to a 2.5 for Split. I might go up to a 4 for Unbreakable.
Nope. But, nope.
I'm a quantum. I give quantum ratings.
That's where you jump into the middle of the movie, and Al tries to get you back out by pushing buttons on Ziggy the whole time.
He's hoping that maybe the next rating is the last.
My Schrodinger's ranking. I'm gonna steal that and use that on my own podcast.
All right. You can contact us with a voicemail at 805-328-3966. You can email us at pod@gncast.com. You can leave us a message on the website. You could follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, but you won't.
They should. They should tell me. Not
going to. You can follow you could subscribe on iTunes, but you won't.
They could. They should.
Yeah, but they're not. Stitcher, Google Play, whichever one you're not going to follow us on.
Well, to be fair, I don't follow you on any of those.
That's fine. You can leave us a review at bit.ly/potreview, but you're not gonna.
No, I
probably. All subscription options and links can be found at gncast.com/subscribe, but you're not gonna. Finally, you can join us on Facebook for the entire network, the Galactic Network, but you won't.
Actually, there's quite a few people who do follow the Galactic Network. It has nothing to do with us, I'm sure.
No, well, what kind of quality stuff do you tweet out with the podcast and Twitter account? What kind of, you get good horror movie gifs? Funny hashtags. What do we get from your Twitter? Besides, do you just literally just link out when there's new episodes?
I don't even do it that often.
Yeah, seriously. I think he likes people who mention us without mentioning the show.
I feel like I have to.
So what I tried to do back in the day, and I no longer keep it up, but I'm trying to get back into it, was I was like, I'm going to devote 15 minutes a day to the podcast no matter what. 15 minutes. This was when we were really like we were doing two episodes a week. And most of that would just be like going on Twitter and either like retweeting a listener or just coming up with a funny Simpsons GIF or commenting on one of the popular hashtags with the Simpsons GIF. Just
I remember getting a newsletter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that we have the newsletter is that's all Dan. I didn't do much with that, but if you did that with your Twitter, I bet you'd see your followers spike, because there is a horror movie community out there that haven't found you yet. Just like, I don't know why every time a discussion online for this about how The Simpsons isn't good anymore comes up. I don't know. We have not done our jobs where we don't come up at all, like on the thread, but you got to market yourself. Do a horror movie GIF. Give me a horror movie GIF.
I use the Facebook page every once in a while, but it's mostly to promote someone else that's friends with us. Like if I see PJ has got something going on, I try to post it to the Facebook page when I see it. If I see some of Tori's articles, that kind of stuff, because people have been so supportive of us and this show that I just want to support them back. And I feel like the people listen to the show, and if they're not into social media and shit, it's not like we're good at that stuff. But thank you for listening. That's the important thing for that. Yeah, but if I can say something like, hey, our friend Anthony has got his new movie coming out, and point it at anybody who might pay attention to our page, that's what you're going to see.
And that's a good incentive for people, for your listeners to listen. You don't have to get a silly GIF or anything, but if you like Podcast of Terror, you might like their friend shows. So your word should be bond, or at least a good suggestion.
Yeah.
So if there is one listener, I want to get you one extra follower. I want to see if you have one follower. Let's just stick with Twitter. Keep it simple.
Okay.
I want you to have one additional follower by the time you have another new episode. So I am beseeching, if you are listening to this and you have Twitter and you're like, I could follow him, but who cares? I get it. We all have our shows like that. But I'm telling you, if you are one of those people in that majority, just go on. Give him a follow. It's not going to kill anybody. Yeah, that should be your motto. Podcast of Terror. It's not going to kill anybody.
That's funny.
All right. I want to see if I can get you that one follower. You're probably going to lose followers.
I think we would get more followers if we actually killed people.
All right. I'm going to look right now to see how many followers we have on Twitter.
What's our number before my proclamation went out?
By the way, we're most likely to get new followers when we have a guest on that we haven't had on before, because then they'll follow us.
I see that you don't have that this time. Me and Ben.
Yeah, we have Jack on for the 15th time.
Oh, my 15, my Quintanilla.
I actually don't know. Let me check. We have 211 followers on Twitter.
All right, let's get it to 212, baby. Boiling point.
Jack.
I do love the fact that Jack was here for 150th, though.
Oh, this is our 150?
It does work. Yeah, it does work that way. Jack, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I believe this is 12.
Hey, Baker's Dozen minus 1. All right, I have to go. I'm losing it.
Yeah, no. Yeah, this is number 12 for you, so we'll make it to 15 one way or another. But yeah, Jack, where do you want people to find you?
I need some followers on Twitter, actually. For the first time, I'm following more than getting followers, and it's been it's only like by 5 or 6, and it's been bothering the shit out of me, my OCD. So I want them back to matching, equal. So I need like 6 or 7 new followers. Jackie No Breaks is on Twitter.
Jackie No Breaks.
Yeah, JACKIENOBRAKES, because I don't stop. Just keep going.
It's the worst episode ever in 90s percentile also.
Oh, yeah, my podcast. Yeah, go listen to those.
Maybe Gremlins 3.
The nice thing about those podcasts is they are both evergreen shows. There's no reason to feel like you're coming in at the wrong time, because it's not about keeping up with the Simpsons month to month. It's keeping up with the Simpsons as the worst shit they've ever done. And 90s percentile. The 90s already happened. Guess what? You can go and listen to the whole thing.
But all of our inside jokes build on one another. So
that's true.
So you also have to listen to all of them in order.
Yep.
I don't make it easy. I don't make it easy. That's why I'm single, and that's why I don't have any podcasts at the moment. I don't make it easy.
Corey, what are you? Do whatever.
Corey's at. Come on, Corey is at. I know this. I know all your names by heart because I'm on Twitter so much.
No, yeah, but Captain Temerity on Twitter. It's C. Christian Scott on Instagram.
C with a period after it. My Twitter, I still don't have access to.
Wait, why?
I lost access to Twitter when I switched cell phones recently, and I couldn't get them to accept me. I sent in to tech support. It's been a couple of months now. They haven't given me access back. And I feel a huge weight off my shoulders of trying to pretend to like Twitter for the last 10 years. I don't give a flying fuck. So I'm more than okay with it. Last week I was talking to our guest about TikTok of all things, and it's not like I'm somebody who's getting around on TikTok, but I'm going through this. Yeah, exactly. It's like, so what? There's a billion social media things out there, and I'm not good with any of them except Facebook because that's where my family is. I don't recommend anybody who's not on Facebook to get onto it.
Can I tell you?
If you're smart, you'll just leave.
I tell you, I saw a really funny, I don't know what TikTok really is or I've used it, but I saw a really funny meme on Twitter that said, if you're trying to use TikTok like it's Vine, it's just like in post-apocalyptic movies when people are doing puppet shows and burnt out TVs. And I thought that was such a brilliant comparison.
That is pretty good.
Like, I don't know what TikTok is, but I already now have an idea of what it is based on that metaphor.
It's like 15 seconds of mouthing to music or whatever, or scenes for movies. It's just basically it's mimicry, but then they have a live aspect of people come on there and talk. They have, you can do a whole video yourself that can be stretched past that 15 seconds if you want, but it's like what Vine was.
Right. All right. Well,
the best.
I probably don't have time to.
No, you don't. The best thing on TikTok was people, it would play the beginning of the YMCA song, and then they would take something out of the fridge.
Oh, yes.
Walked up to someone, and as soon as the song would kick in, they would throw it at them.
You would hear like the slap of the cheese hitting the face. Like I saw somebody running cheese underwater in the sink and then walking through the house, and then all of a sudden you hear that young man slap, yep. And the cheese would just be in that person's face. I don't know why that cracks me up every time.
That's the whole reason I stayed on TikTok for 3 days.
TikTok for me is mostly, it's just like Instagram. I just like everything with cats and dogs.
Yes. All right, let's wrap this up so Jack can go to the couch.
I have to, well, actually, it's a couch right now. I have to turn it to my bed.
Yeah, you just go 36 inches behind you.
I'm sleeping on this pulpit.
Corey, do you have anything you want to push, or did we cover it for you?
Hey, our guest next week, Phil Rude, is going to be on, and Phil's a friend of mine for a number of years, and I was on his podcast recently, but he just launched a comic book on Webtoons, not a comic book, but like pages of a comic story on Webtoons. And it's a sci-fi thing with a cat. He's probably going to talk about it next week, so he'll be able to give the URL and all that. But Phil's a great guy, so you should definitely check him out. And he's a really talented artist. So that's what I'm looking forward to, and that's what I'm enjoying this week is Phil's stuff.
Don't forget your extra Twitter follower so that you have that to look forward to this week, too.
Jack, you're going to have to remind me at next week to make sure that we have 212.
I'm not going to remind you. I'm not going to do any of that.
I'm not going to remember either. That's why. God damn it.
It'll be great. That's fun.
This is why it's so important to us to get an extra Twitter follower so we can not pay attention if it happens.
Yeah. All right.
It's funny that the generation of burnouts is the generation that brought podcasting into the...
Yeah.
We love podcasting, but we're also fucking tired.
We got jaded fast.
Took us 150 episodes. All right. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram and Untapped at Mental Lifeguard. Corey already said it. Next week, what we're doing? We're watching The Descendants. Phil Rude.
He should do this stuff. He's much better at it than you. I
asked him to, and then he doesn't have a TV large enough to be able to read it from across the room, so he made me do it.
we're gonna get him a teleprompter.
Fuck. When he moved back to California, or when he moved back to Michigan from California, we lost all of our Amazon affiliate income.
I wanted to buy a huge scoreboard. It was like $100, and it was this gigantic scoreboard, and I wanted to make it our 60-minute timer.
Oh.
It's one of the many, many reasons I now realize I should have never left Wii Studios. It was a huge mistake. I mean, I've saved thousands of dollars that I don't know how I could have pulled off staying there. But there's a bunch of reasons why I should have. And one of them is I would have been able to convert a permanent. I would have been able to make a permanent studio space with my girlfriend gone. Mm-hmm. And I would have had that clock and I was ready to buy it. Oh, it would have been so cool. But well, one day we'll have the studio of our dreams, boys. One day.
One day. Yeah. When you move to Wisconsin or Michigan.
Is there a state in between? Minnesota?
Nope. There's a lake in between.
I'll move to the lake. I'll live in an island.
Gonna live on an
island in the middle of the lake, and there'll be a line down it. Half will be Corey and half will be Matt. And
yep.
I'll be equidistant.
In the middle, we fuck.
We have a very small island next to our house you can live on. It's teeny, but it's probably bigger than your apartment right now.
I mean, I think everybody who listens to the show and has gotten to know me knows whatever my end is, it's going to end up with me like alone on some island. That was the destiny all along.
All right, so that's going to do it for another episode of the podcast. Here, we will talk to you guys next week.
Stay scary, everybody, on Twitter.
All right.
Sorry, I had to cut it a little early.
No, that's fine. Growly,
I think I kept Matt past his witching hour last week.
Last week got really late for me because we trumped your episode time wise.
I saw that.
That's why I was like, well, these guys, this may be like a 4-hour episode, so let's start early.
I thought that's why you're starting at noon, you motherfucker.
I wanted to do something with Dan. I never convinced him to do that. I really wanted to do. When FX was doing the Simpsons marathons, I wanted to live stream us watching it for 24 hours. I couldn't convince him.
Nice.
And like, you know, I would have brought in a bunch of guests. So like every hour we would kind of do a, you know, sometimes we would record a couple episodes of the podcast. A lot of the times we would take turns sleeping and like, you know, we would answer questions and, you know, I really wanted to see if we could, and like, I thought maybe it would go viral. Like, you know, these Simpsons fans do 24-hour marathon live stream, but I never convinced them.
Well, they've been doing those Shutter marathons with I can't think of his name.
Billy Bob.
Billy Bob, yeah. And so it's Joe Bob. Yeah, Joe Bob Briggs.
Yeah.
So yeah, and I think that would be really fun because I don't know how much of it is done live as they're watching it or if they do it in between the segments, but yeah, it's still pretty enjoyable to just see somebody kind of chat up and do stuff in the movies, but. He's at a different level than we are.
Yeah, I know. We'll get there. We'll get the studio. We'll get the scoreboard. We'll get Joe Bob. It'll be great.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, guys. Sorry, I was a little tired today.
Oh, that's fine. I got to go eat dinner.
Yeah, you were real low energy, Jack.
Fucking prick. All right. I'll talk to you guys later.
Thanks a lot, guys.
See ya.
Bye. Bye, chat. Really appreciate you being here.